Tor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Russia in Flames, War, Revolution, Civil War, 1914 to 1921, by Laura Engelstein. Narrated by Anne Flosnik. Oh, you children, if only you knew what hunger and darkness are waiting for you. Alexander Block. Voice from the Chorus, Golas Is Hora, 1910 to 1914. Gorge on pineapple, chomp on grouse, your days are numbered, bourgeois louse. Vladimir Mayakovsky, 1917, in Vladimir Ilyich Lenin, 1925. The population is the class enemy. Andrei Platonov, Hurdy-gurdy, Sharmanka, circa 1930. Author's note. All translations are my own, unless otherwise indicated. When transliterating Russian from the Cyrillic alphabet, I've used a modified Library of Congress system. In the text, the names of well-known figures are anglicized. Kerensky, Trotsky. Pyotr Tchaikovsky, the composer, but Nikolai Tchaikovsky, the revolutionary. Place names offer complications of their own. Some were multiple at the time. Lithuanian Vilnius, Russian Vilna, Polish Vilno, German Lemberg, Polish Lvov, Russian Lvov, Ukrainian Lviv. Some changed when borders changed. Some were rechristened for political reasons. St. Petersburg, Petrograd. When the differences are part of the story, they will be indicated, but the choice of one over the other should not be taken as endorsement of any current national claim. English equivalents will be used when possible, thus Warsaw, Moscow, Kiev. As for the issue of dates, the Bolsheviks marked the political rupture by switching to a new calendar. On February 1, 1918, by the Julian calendar used in Russia, the Bolsheviks adopted the Gregorian calendar used in the West, which in the 20th century was 13 days ahead. Thus, February 1, 1918, Old Style became February 14, 1918, New Style, although the Russian Orthodox Church and some opponents of the Bolsheviks in the Civil War rejected the change. Up to January 31, 1918, I use old-style, Julian calendar dates for domestic events, indicating new-style, Gregorian calendar, for dates of international significance or when double perspective is needed. Introduction. In 1913, the Romanov dynasty celebrated three centuries of rule. In August 1914, Russia went to war against Germany and Austria-Hungary. Less than 3 years later, in February 1917, by the old Julian calendar, the last of the Romanovs fell from power. Incapable of prosecuting the war, the monarchy had succeeded only in forfeiting the loyalty of its subjects. In February, Imperial Russian society, from top to bottom, rose up against the autocratic regime. Tsar Nicholas II was forced to abdicate, and the leaders of respectable society installed themselves in the seat of power. The workers and soldiers who had brought the monarchy to bay followed the lead of moderate socialists in establishing a political arena of their own. Aware of their tenuous claim to rule, the revolutionaries of the first hour were still saddled with the burden of war, and faced with the popular unrest, now in organized form, which had enabled their own break with the past. In October 1917, as the crisis deepened, Vladimir Lenin's Bolshevik party staged a coup d'état that dislodged the bourgeois office holders, stole the moderates' thunder, and inaugurated 4 years of civil conflict, ending in early 1921 with the consolidation of history's first socialist government. It took more than 10 days to shake the world. The monarchy was ousted by the representatives of privileged society, backed by the fury of soldiers, peasants, and workers, whose long-term grievances had been pushed to the edge by the war. The men who assumed the reins of government were constitutional conservatives aiming to control, not intensify, disorder. But in toppling the sovereign power, they had taken a revolutionary step. From the beginning, the revolution held out the possibility of a democratic outcome, a potential dramatized by the remarkable turnout for elections to the empire-wide constituent assembly, even after the Bolsheviks had taken command. The potential for civil war was also implicit in the revolution from the beginning. As the crisis deepened, a group of officers attempted unsuccessfully to seize control and prevent the left from gaining ground. But it was the October coup that tipped the balance into armed warfare. The military and socialist establishment, which had supported the February Revolution in the hopes of prosecuting the war more successfully, rallied its forces against the usurpers, whom they viewed not only as political extremists, but as pawns of enemy German power. The civil war unleashed by the coup was deep and extensive, embracing every corner of the empire, from the ethnic borderlands to the peasant heartland, at every rung of the social hierarchy. It was a story of crisis and collapse, but also of surprising resilience. The chaos on the streets and behind the front revealed enduring allegiances and habits of collective action. The institutions of civil society, rudimentary though they were, provided a platform for political mobilization. At the pinnacle of power, the elites battled each other for control. But at the level of the state, the basis of power, political authority, a functioning bureaucratic apparatus, and monopoly of the legitimate use of physical force, as Max Weber put it, had itself been shaken. Power was not simply there to be seized, it had to be reconstructed. All parties to the civil war fought with savage intensity. In the end, the Bolsheviks proved the most adept at controlling and deploying violence, at shaping new instruments with which to impose social discipline and compel consent. The civil war was thus in part a war waged by the monarchy's emerging successor, having repurposed its vestigial institutions against the remnants of the old society and the old regime in order to build a radically new social order. Even when it emerged victorious, the Soviet state continued to wage war against the society it had brought into being, as though the process of transformation and subjugation was never complete. The civil war was extraordinarily brutal on all sides. Unfolding over a vast territory, the conflict consisted of many interlocking wars and caused immense material and human damage. Demographers have estimated total losses, military and civilian, between 1918 and 1922, out of a population of about 170 million, at over 15.5 million, or about 9%. The total included 2.5 million victims of violence on and off the battlefields, 2 million victims of terror from all sides, 6 million who succumbed to starvation and disease, and the 5 million victims of famine in 1921. None of the contenders were able to control the conduct of the improvised forces they deployed. None shied away from forms of violence, such as hostage-taking, reprisals against civilians, summary executions, rape and torture, and the targeting of ethnic communities, considered at the time as violations of moral, if not also legal, norms. The Bolsheviks, in the end, were most effective in institutionalizing the violence they needed to win, and with which, in its organized form, they proceeded to build a new social order. At its core, however, the revolution was not a military, but a political struggle in all its interlocking dimensions, and that struggle is the focus of this book. It is a political contest in which the ideal of democracy, of broad participation in the workings of power, achieved enormous resonance at all levels of society, and was ultimately betrayed. It was a contest in which warfare became a political medium and a substitute for politics. Here was the Bolshevik key to success. The story of war, revolution, and civil war is very much also an imperial story. In 1914, the Russian Empire extended west to east from the Finnish Gulf to the Pacific Ocean, north to south from the White Sea to the Black Sea. Almost three-quarters of the population lived west of the Ural Mountains, in what was called European Russia. To the east lay the vast expanse of Siberia. The western border included Finland, the Baltic littoral, a large portion of the former Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, and most of what is today Ukraine. The southern periphery included the mountainous Caucasus region and the steppes and deserts of Central Asia, reaching to the Chinese border. Only 15% of the overall population lived in cities. But Russia was rapidly changing. In 1913, the capital, St. Petersburg, renamed Petrograd in August 1914, had 2.5 million inhabitants. Moscow, 2 million. Manufacture, science, and many of the attributes of urban civilization were producing a bourgeoisie, an industrial working class, a professional elite, civic associations, and a market for books, newspapers, and culture, both high and low. Europe took notice. In 1906, impresario Sergei Diaghilev mounted an exhibit of Russian modernist painting in Paris, which was all the rage. In 1913, his Ballet Russe staged Igor Stravinsky's The Rite of Spring, creating a sensation with its shocking theme and discordant rhythms, a foretaste of the primitivist modernism that was to characterize the revolutionary years. There is no doubt that Imperial Russia was evolving. Had it not been for the trauma of the Great War, which also destroyed the Hohenzollern, Habsburg, and Ottoman empires, Russia might conceivably have developed towards some form of capitalist society, with a truly representative and empowered political system. Indeed, the monarchy itself actively promoted economic advance. Yet that same regime, which considered itself autocratic down to the very end, clung to its monopoly on power. It was only the revolution of 1905, roiling the empire from stem to stern, that extracted the concession of an elected parliament, the State Duma, from the unwilling sovereign, who continued to regard it with disdain and allowed his ministers to limit its operation and diminish its mandate. The contradiction between the persistent traditionalism of the monarchy and the growing pressure for an expanded civic arena and a meaningful political role for the establishment elites for share in power, developments which had accompanied the emergence of civil society in the West, led to ever-growing tensions and seemed to justify the posture of the radical political extremes. The Great War provided an opportunity for society in a swell of patriotic fervor to assert its claim to a role in the management of public affairs. Despite its distrust of independent social forces, however patriotic they might be, the regime was obliged to solicit their cooperation. While increasingly seen as unable to meet the challenge of a war that demanded the engagement of civilian as well as military forces, the monarchy stubbornly refused to broaden access to political life. The chronic friction between the state and its loyal but frustrated public intensified with each passing month. This was, moreover, a war that placed a heavy burden on the mass of the labouring population. Peasants in uniform, peasants pressed for grain, industrial workers struggling to feed their families. Above all, it was a war in which the government itself was at cross-purposes, the army high command pursuing policies that disrupted the domestic economy and aggravated social tensions, its own propaganda fueling international conflicts. In short, it must be said, the old regime contributed largely to its own demise. In undermining its own authority, the monarchy opened the door to defiance of authority across the board. Mutiny, industrial strikes, the burning and pillaging of rural estates. When the revolution erupted in February 1917, however, it was more than a revolt of the masses against the power of their superiors and the demands of the war. The men who took matters into their own hands and turned against the monarchy were the notables of the State Duma, backed by critical figures in the military high command. Duma deputies representing the propertied and privileged classes then created what they called a provisional government. Meanwhile, Duma deputies from the moderate socialist parties formed a leadership organ for the popular movement that had flooded the streets of Petrograd and forced the Duma's hand. They used the model pioneered in the 1905 revolution to establish the Petrograd Soviet. Both the provisional government and the Petrograd Soviet defined themselves as placeholders, uneasy in exercising the power they had actively claimed. Yet the ideals and symbols of socialism had broad popular appeal across party lines, and the desire for political representation transcended class divides. It was only toward the end of 1917 that the Bolshevik Party emerged as the sole organized force, ready to assert its own right to power in no uncertain terms. The Bolshevik claim was at first very weak, indeed derisory, as some of the leading Bolsheviks themselves understood. Their first move, on Lenin's urgent insistence, was to take Russia out of the war. The war had been the monarchy's undoing, and the provisional government's Achilles' heel. Peace had been a crucial demand of the rebellious soldiers, reacting not only to the strains of prolonged combat, but also to the shortages and hardship on the home front. The promise of peace became a defining feature of the Bolshevik appeal. Yet even a majority of Bolsheviks resisted Lenin's demand to lay down arms, which he viewed as the only means of maintaining their fragile claim to rule. They preferred to pin their hopes for the salvation of the Russian gamble on the outbreak of world revolution. The October takeover was itself enough to provoke an armed response to the Bolshevik challenge. In the end, however, it was the outrage and enormity of the separate peace concluded with the Central Powers at Brest-Litovsk in March 1918 over the objections not only of Lenin's comrades, but of their left SR allies, that solidified the Bolsheviks' bold assertion of power. It was the opposition to the peace that energized resistance to the Bolshevik move even on the left, thus compelling the comrades to circle the wagons and deepening their antagonism to competing forces in the political field. Always having an enemy, insisting on the incompatibility of positions, the need for sharp distinctions and clear divides, these had been Vladimir Lenin's political calling cards from the moment of the party's inception. Through relentless propaganda, the organization of language and ideas, as well as institutions, the party continually simplified and clarified who we are against, who bests whom. Kato Kavor, in Lenin's brutal shorthand. Now the party was the state, acting upon society, to conquer its resistance and reconstruct it from the inside out, erecting a new state structure and a new form of power. In time and with great effort, the Bolsheviks succeeded in the course of the Civil War, first of all in reconstituting the army, not only as a fighting force, but as the core of a new social formation, the mechanism for restructuring society itself. Bolshevik victory was an act of war. It was accomplished not only with guns and military discipline, but by the onslaught of words and images, visual and verbal. Graphic artists who had filled the satirical journals with their barbs in 1905, playing hide-and-seek with the censor, now took their aim at new targets. Poets wrote lyrics and ditties, modernist iconoclasts built stage sets, designed spectacles and posters. A new culture with a new vocabulary and a new moral tone was disseminated widely. The newspaper, the slogan, the red banner, the bloodthirsty song. The Bolshevik idiom was part of a more pervasive socialist culture, which had begun under the impact of 1905 to expand beyond the radical fringe. The red flag, the Marseillaise, the idea of the proletariat as a positive moral force became symbols of liberation, of opposition to the autocratic old regime. On a popular level, such attitudes had coexisted with veneration of the monarch and with the aura of traditional symbols, not least those of religion, well into the war. But revolutionary iconography created a shared sense of moral purpose. The socialist repertoire crossed ideological divides embracing Marxist social democrats, SDs, Bolsheviks and Mensheviks, populist socialist revolutionaries, SRs, bomb-throwing anarchist terrorists, and numerous splinters in between. Though united by common values and aspirations, the socialist camp was deeply divided on matters of tactics and the use of violence. The grassroots-oriented Mensheviks and moderate SRs endorsed the Soviets but opposed the October coup. The more radical left SRs, by contrast, helped legitimate the regime of the People's Commissars by their participation. After Brest-Litovsk, the SRs helped solidify Bolshevik rule in reverse by withdrawing their support. Outraged by the treaty and by Bolshevik treatment of the peasantry, the SRs turned against their temporary allies, giving the Bolsheviks an excuse, if one were needed, to intensify their attack on challenges from the left, eliminating competing claims to authority or allegiance. The Bolsheviks were clarifiers and monopolists. They created a distinctive brand. The original capaciousness of the socialist vision and symbolism as a language of contestation at the same time served them as a means of extending and certifying their own rule. The Bolshevik Revolution inspired generations of idealists in Russia and the West with the vision of a just society. From the start, it also inspired fierce opposition across the political spectrum as an inherently flawed project. Many of its early champions became disillusioned only later, when Stalin seemed to have betrayed the revolution's original democratic hopes. Nikita Khrushchev's repudiation of Stalin's crimes in his secret speech of 1956 left the Leninist ideal untarnished. Once the Soviet Union had crumbled, and with it the official ideology of Great October, and once the archives had opened their files, the question of the revolution's original character acquired a new life. In fact, there were no halcyon days of the Bolshevik Revolution. There was no primal moment of democratic purity that was later betrayed, though the hopes pinned on October were certainly disappointed. The Bolsheviks were ruthless and uncompromising from day one. Leading Bolsheviks disagreed and argued with each other over tactics. Key decisions met with resistance, notably the timing of the October coup and the acceptance of Brest-Litovsk, but discipline held. Lenin remained the centre of authority, even when challenged. The SRs split, the Mensheviks split, the Bolsheviks, though sometimes divided, did not split. They created organisations. They operated simultaneously on many levels to mobilise and direct, to punish and penalise. Alexander Kerensky, the outstanding figure of the early days of the provisional government, was a charismatic speaker, the focus of admiration and adoration in the wake of the Tsar's ignominious decline. But he had no effective instrument of rule and no clear, always decisive direction. The reasons for the failure of the constitutional experiment of early 1917 nevertheless cannot be reduced to the issue of Kerensky's fall from grace. There is no two-word answer to the question of why the proponents of popular democracy failed and the Bolsheviks managed to impose their vision, especially since success was not instant, but the product of a prolonged and vicious struggle. Ideology was important, but the socialists had a broad, not exclusive, appeal. Mensheviks and SRs posed a real threat to Bolshevik ambitions. The key to Bolshevik victory was their superior ability to mobilize violence, not only as a destructive force, but as a tool in the hands of key state institutions, the army and the Cheka, the secret police established within weeks of the October takeover as a bureaucratic organization. The Bolsheviks were relentless state builders in the service of a radical social vision, but the state came first. Bolshevik methods, as well as their goals, generated opposition in many quarters. Inheriting the mantle of empire, the commissars resisted the efforts of outlying regions to free themselves from central rule. Inheriting the need to feed an army and supply the cities, they confronted the same rage and resentment the peasants had earlier directed against the policies of the old regime. They encountered the same defiance of discipline the soldiers had directed against officers with epaulettes. In the heartland, the Russian elites mobilized against them. Career officers in Siberia and the South formed armies and courted a popular following with ideologies of their own, notably anti-Semitism. Political moderates, for their part, were often confronted with difficult, if not impossible, choices between different forms of demagogy and sometimes indistinguishable forms of brutality. Nobody's hands were clean. In the end, the Bolsheviks prevailed. They succeeded not only because they were determined and ingenious when it came to organization, propaganda, and political maneuvers, or because they were unsentimental in viewing revolution as a form of war. Although their policies generated massive popular resistance, their message resonated deeply among the dispossessed of the old regime. It was a message that summoned, before eviscerating, the longed-for democratic ideal, an ideal embodied in the Soviets as well as the provisional government. In the Constituent Assembly, for which millions voted while the country was still at war, in the many grassroots committees and provincial city dumas, there was a propulsive dynamic between the leaders of the Bolshevik Party, especially once they managed to hang on to the instruments of state and what they called the broad masses. They attracted not only workers, in whose name they spoke, but ambitious young peasant men, out to survive and to change their lives by joining the Red Army. They appealed to Jewish youth and Jewish intellectuals, freed from the anti-Semitism of the old regime, because the Bolsheviks took them on board. Intellectuals, artists, writers, technicians, dramatists, poets, scientists welcomed the promise of modernity, of a rational society, of a newly imagined future, which they saw themselves as helping to create. The matter of the party's social constituency is not straightforward, however. It is not always clear that barely schooled adherents distinguished this particular version of the socialist appeal from the other varieties of the left, or signifying a principled antagonism to the old society and its constraints. The Bolshevik temper may, however, have better suited the ferocity of the moment, though the SRs were unscrupulous too. The followers may have offered their allegiance because the Bolsheviks came to stand not only for resistance to power, but for power itself. And many, of course, did not accept them and rebelled from early on in the party's ascendancy. How the Bolsheviks managed in the end both to create a new kind of rule and to sustain it is part of the drama that transfigured the lands of the old empire and transformed the political landscape of the 20th century. Within the old borders, they were bested only in those peripheral though important regions that made their escape and established independent entities of their own. The nationalist leaders of what emerged as Poland, Estonia, Latvia, Lithuania, and Finland also managed to harness popular support for the project of state building, although not without considerable outside help. Attempts to do the same thing in the Ukrainian provinces, by contrast, were not successful. The drama of the Civil War thus raises a number of key questions. What makes states work, and what makes them fail? How authority can be lost and then re-established? How legitimacy is squandered and regained? And what makes a democratic form of government a feasible option? In the summer of 1917, in the aftermath of a failed popular revolt against the provisional government, for which the Bolsheviks were held responsible, Lenin left Petrograd and took refuge in nearby Finland. There he wrote a pamphlet called State and Revolution. It projected a future in which the state apparatus would no longer be necessary, since class differences would have disappeared, and with them the need for a powerful minority to control and exploit the oppressed. In a state that was no longer an instrument of power, thus no longer in fact a state, administration would be all that remained, applying technical expertise to the practical matter of running a just and equitable society. This stateless vision of social as well as political justice, which Lenin derived from Marx, is what inspired many intellectuals, as well as ordinary people, at the time and long after. This was the shining destination, but the state was not destined simply to wither away, in the words of Friedrich Engels, which Lenin insisted had often been misunderstood. The state must first be used to destroy the old order and eliminate the class oppressors rallying in its defense. For this purpose, it would have to become more, not less, powerful. During this transitional stage, the proletariat would exercise a ruthless political dictatorship. State and revolution has been interpreted variously as an expression of Bolshevik utopianism and as an example of Bolshevik authoritarianism. In neither case, however, is Lenin's vision democratic. Lenin does not imagine democracy as a political system. He allows for no political process, no institutional basis for the expression and resolution of conflict, no mechanism for the exercise of power based in society. Lenin's vision, as portrayed in State and Revolution, returns to the pre-1970 model of a central authority presiding over a social organism that lacks the attributes of civil society, in the political sense. It lacks autonomous associations, freedom of expression, and the mechanisms for managing the disparate interests inherent in any complex community. The Soviet Union did not revive the old regime, but it updated some of its essential features. It was undemocratic and unfree, and even more brutally repressive. Almost all the political figures mentioned in this account, except those who had died natural deaths, fallen in battle or emigrated, were murdered in the 1930s purges. The war against itself that Russia inaugurated in 1918 lasted a long time. This book tells the story of the Russian Revolution, from its roots in World War I to the conclusion of the Civil War in February 1921, as a political drama shaped by immense social forces beyond anyone's control, buffeted by conflicts embedded in the international state system, bearing the imprint not only of the experience of the war, but of the legacy of the outmoded autocracy. It is a story that takes divergent paths, as the empire fragments and political movements come and go. It is hard to do justice to any one of its components, but in outlining its broad contours, some general patterns emerge. The actors in the drama are collective: peasantry, soldiery, workers, cultural communities, and individual at all levels. No leader acts alone, but some have a decisive impact on events. In this case, the role of Lenin and Trotsky is hard to underestimate. Nothing was inevitable about the outcome of these years of bloodshed and strife. Many decisions mattered. The presence of key players, a Lenin or a Trotsky, is nevertheless not enough to explain the collapse of one civilization and the birth of another. The revolution and civil wars that enveloped the Romanov domains were part of the grand sweep of the World War, but also a product of cultural and institutional patterns rooted in the imperial Russian past. Their legacy persists in today's Russia, even after the Soviet Union's demise in 1991. The Russian Revolution hovered over the 20th century, a beacon to many on the left, a tragedy or an opportunity to many who lived through it and later experienced its results, demonic to many on the political right. In 1979, British historian E.H. Carr predicted that historians would continue to consider October 1917 a turning point in history, but would disagree on whether it constituted a landmark in the emancipation of mankind from past oppression, or a crime and a disaster. In the Soviet Union, of course, the Great October Revolution was celebrated as the regime's foundational moment. In 1996, the holiday was renamed. In today's Russia, the date is no longer even marked. President Vladimir Putin has condemned the Treaty of Brest-Litovsk for having betrayed the national interest. As a consequence of war, revolution, and civil war, he declares, Russia was destroyed from within. Despite such grand pronouncements, scholars in post-Soviet Russia have been intent on getting beyond the political uses of the revolution and beyond the kind of alternatives E.H. Carr proposed. In the past 25 years, they have mined the newly opened archives for previously inaccessible documents, which they have published in meticulously annotated volumes for the use of the international scholarly community. This book owes an enormous debt to the work they have done, and the moral passion with which they have attempted to dismantle clichés and think differently. Take, for example, a collection of hitherto unavailable material on the attempt of Central Asian political leaders after October 1917 to establish the basis for self-government against the threat of Soviet domination. Published in 1992 in Almaty, then the capital of the newly constituted Republic of Kazakhstan, when hopes for democracy in the region were running high, the volume begins with a warning against the mindless rejection of unfamiliar positions, different convictions, other ways of looking at reality. Insofar as the drama of 1917 and its consequences have receded into the past, especially for citizens of the West, we need to be reminded of its importance, how unprecedented and monumental the events really were, while avoiding the old antinomies, in which Lenin is either a hero or a devil, in which the so-called masses are either paragons of high-minded dedication to a selfless cause or mere perpetrators of mindless violence. October 1917 was indeed a coup, which took advantage of and then deepened a genuine social revolution. It also suffocated the eloquent desire for democratic self-representation displayed by all segments of Imperial Russian society in their different ways throughout the revolutionary year and deep into the Civil War. 100 years is a long enough distance from which to question the terms in which to consider these world-shaking events. This book tells a story in which all the categories are inevitably laden with moral and political judgments. Proletariat, counter-revolution, red terror, and in which such judgments cannot be avoided, but a story that must be told with some degree of detachment from the ideological positions that animated the revolution in the first place. We live at a time in which the democracy that the transatlantic world has come to take for granted since the end of World War II and the defeat of fascism may be seriously endangered. The great historical moment between 1917 and 1921, in which the cost of democracy's failure became all too apparent, deserves our renewed attention. Part 1. Last Years of the Old Empire, 1904 to 1914. The Russian Empire began the 20th century, in 1905, with a revolution. Long in the making, it was a surprise nonetheless. Anyone who has read Turgenev, Fathers and Sons, Dostoevsky, The Possessed, also known as The Demons, or Joseph Conrad, Under Western Eyes, will know that the dream or nightmare of revolution haunted 19th century Russia. The specter of communism evoked by Marx was most at home on Europe's eastern margins. Yet the revolutionary movement did not create the revolution. The revolution of 1905 was a product of the dilemma facing Russia's old regime, an autocratic state which had survived into the modern era. To maintain its standing as a great power, the empire had to embrace the very changes that threatened the basis of its rule. It needed industry, technology, and literacy, but without their political consequences. Parliaments, public opinion, civil society, and the dread proletariat. To survive as an imperial regime, the autocracy must cease to be autocratic. The results of this tension were explosive. The upheaval that began in January 1905 lasted for a good 2 years. The turmoil, once subdued, was followed by a decade of continuing political confrontation between the forces behind the revolution and the regime they had not managed to unseat. This confrontation centered in the State Duma. The elected parliament wrested from the unwilling Tsar, who resented the incursion on absolute power but saw no other way to survive. The concessions unwillingly granted were immediately undermined by imperial decree, even before the opening of the Duma's first session. Once the last vestiges of unrest were under control, the electoral laws were changed, also by a decree, to restrict the Duma franchise. In the 7 years until the outbreak of war in 1914, society continued its battle with the regime, now by means of the Duma, however limited its mandate, and in the court of public opinion, however restricted its scope. It was thus an already mobilized society that encountered the challenge of the Great War, which at first rallied the public in support of the patriotic effort, but soon had the effect of undermining the monarchy altogether. The political roots of 1905 date to the 1860s. In 1861, as the United States was embarking on the civil war that ended slavery, Alexander II liberated the Russian serfs by imperial decree. Defeat in 1856 in the Crimean War had shown that Russia could not compete as a great power in the modern world with unfree labor and an undereducated elite. Emancipation was followed by the Great Reforms, which created representative organs of local administration, the zemstvos, reshaped the courts, and updated the terms and conditions of military service. Basic education expanded, the universities grew, and the professions developed. Yet the emergence of civil society, the sphere of public discussion and association, remained crippled by the monarchy's distrust of its own subjects, even its own elites. The thinking few were therefore unhappy. They chafed at the limitations on their own freedoms, but were troubled even more by the lot of the vast impoverished peasantry, the people, Narod, constituting 85% of the population. Idealistic Russian youth travelled to the villages. They travelled to Europe to get an education. Women studied medicine abroad. Men and women gathered in reading groups to discuss socialist tracts and champion the equality of the sexes. The populists, Narodniki, dedicated to peasant revolution were unsuccessful, however. In 1881, a handful of populist zealots, disappointed by their own failure and by the inadequate results of the Great Reforms, assassinated the Tsar Liberator. His arch-conservative son, Alexander III, reigned for the next 13 years, followed by his own son, the equally traditionalist Nicholas II. The radicals' bold yet self-defeating act increased the regime's sense of embattlement. It magnified the perpetrator's importance in the eyes of contemporaries and in the retrospective genealogy of Bolshevik victory in 1917. Only one of the assassins was Jewish, but the deed unleashed a wave of anti-Jewish pogroms with ominous portents for the future. The repressive policies of the last two czars continued to alienate the privileged classes, attaching the fringe ever more firmly to the goal of revolution. But revolution itself was a product of the modernizing forces the regime both needed and feared. Officials were frightened not only by homegrown firebrands, but by the example of Europe, where the development of industrial society had generated a proletariat, the ideology of socialism, and most recently the Paris Commune of 1871. It was not clear at the time that capitalism might in the long term be a recipe for stability rather than upheaval. Nevertheless, the path forward was unavoidable. In the wake of the Great Reforms, the development of railroads and the expansion of cities, commerce, industry and science had, by the 1890s, created an arena in which the attributes of Western civilization were clearly visible. Railways, trams, telephones, automobiles, cinema, advertising, high fashion, department stores, factories, factory workers, newspapers, physicians, physicists, Art Nouveau. Chemist Dmitri Mendeleev developed the periodic table. Ivan Pavlov won the Nobel Prize in Physiology in 1904. The figure most closely associated with state promotion of economic development was Count Sergei Vitter. A product of the empire, he was born in the Georgian capital of Tiflis, Tbilisi, where his father held an official position. The family, of Baltic German origin but Orthodox faith, had entered Russian state service in the 16th century. Vitter's second wife was Jewish. He began his own career in the Ministry of Finance Department of Railroads and eventually served as Minister of Finance from 1892 to 1903, peak years of industrial progress, which his policies encouraged. Reform and modernization, contrary to expectation, seemed at first to increase the stability of public life. The Zemstvos, created in 1864, hired agronomists, statisticians, physicians, and schoolteachers to work in the villages. They nurtured a culture of civic responsibility among local gentry and offered a chance for the classes to mingle. Russian public life had greater depth and durability than ever before. Yet the elites in the provinces and the capitals were still denied a legitimate outlet for political action or expression. Nicholas II, when he ascended the throne in 1894, rejected what he dismissed as their senseless dreams of a constitutional order. The educated establishment longed to contribute to a functioning society. The heirs of the populists wanted to destroy it. By the 1890s, in line with the new social landscape, Marxism had challenged the dream of a peasant revolution. The villages had remained quiescent, and revolutionary terror, the assassination of the Tsar Liberator, had failed to topple the regime. The generation that turned to Marx put their wager on the emerging proletariat, the urban factory workers, and took heart from the inroads of capitalism evident even in Russia. Marx himself postulated capitalism as the precondition for the proletarian revolution. The Russian acolytes felt the future was upon them and conceived of Russia as part of a worldwide chain of historical development. The most authoritative figure in the emerging radical generation was Vladimir Ilyich Lenin. Born Ulyanov in 1870 in the Volga River town of Simbirsk, since 1924 Ulyanovsk, 500 miles east of Moscow, he was the younger brother of a populist radical, executed in 1887 for his role in a failed plot to assassinate Alexander III. The first defectors from populism, led by Georgi Plekhanov, 14 years Lenin's senior, had founded the Union of Struggle for the Emancipation of the Working Class in 1883. By 1895, it had become the Union of Russian Social Democrats, for which the 25-year-old Lenin drafted the program. In Minsk, in 1898, its organizers renamed it the Russian Social Democratic Labour Party. Rossiyskaya Social-Demokratichiskaya Rabochaya Partiya. Pinning their hopes on Russia's radical potential, the Social Democrats believed the old anger of the peasant masses and the new anger of the factory slaves would combine to dislodge the feudal monarchy and its budding capitalist class from power simultaneously. Combined and uneven development, Lenin's later co-conspirator Leon Trotsky called it. Born Lev Davidovich Brunstein in 1879 on a farm near the city of Elizabethgrad, later Zinoviask, then Kirovo, today Kropovnitsky, Ukraine, in Kherson province north of the Black Sea. Trotsky was not yet 20 in 1898 when he was arrested for revolutionary activity. After a year in prison and another 2.5 in Siberian exile, where in the company of other exiles he read and wrote and kept abreast of political developments, he fled to Europe, where he joined Lenin and the other comrades, busy plotting revolution. In 1903, the Social Democrats gathered in Brussels for their second party congress, soon shifting to London to escape the Russian police. It was then, in the course of a contentious vote, that the group split into two factions. Winning by a hair, Lenin's followers adopted the name Bolshevik, meaning those of the majority. The losers were known as Mensheviks, those of the minority. Yuli Martov, born Yuli Osipovich Tsedyabaum, in 1873, and raised in Odessa, became the leader of the Menshevik faction. The two sides differed on the fundamental issue of what constituted a revolutionary party and what kind of social movement it should hope to form. Lenin had articulated his vision in a 1902 pamphlet called What is to be Done, in which he called for a vanguard of professional revolutionaries to guide the proletariat in the acquisition of Marxian revolutionary consciousness. The Mensheviks rejected the model of a tightly controlled nucleus of party leaders in favour of a more broadly based grassroots party. They were sceptical as well of the possibility of launching a proletarian revolution in a country where capitalist society had not yet fully evolved. Bourgeois revolution should come first on the agenda. The Social Democrats were not alone in plotting revolution in these years. In 1902, the remnants of the old populist movement had reconstituted themselves as the Socialist Revolutionary Party, which preserved the ideal of a peasant-based communitarian revolution. Like their 19th-century predecessors, they believed that Russian peasant culture was intrinsically collectivist and that the evils of capitalism could be avoided if capitalism were bypassed altogether. They also retained the tradition of political terror. In April 1902, for example, the SRs assassinated Minister of the Interior Dmitry Sipiagin, and in summer 1904 his successor, Vyacheslav Plevya. Viktor Chernov, born in Saratov province in 1873, thus of the same generation as the founding Social Democrats, was the party's leading figure and theoretician. Nor were revolutionaries the only ones forming organizations. In 1902, a group of Zemstvo leaders, committed to moderate social reform and Western-style constitutionalism, joined with Pyotr Struve, one of the original Social Democrats, in founding a journal called Liberation, Osvobozhdenia. It was to be the masthead of what became known as the social movement, Obshestvenne Dvizhenie, understood as the mobilization of society, rather than the laboring masses, either peasant or proletarian. Born in 1870, a son of the governor of Perm province, Struve was originally drawn to Marxism, mostly for its analysis of the importance of capitalism in historical development. After various troubles with the authorities, obligatory for any activist at the time, he began moving toward the political centre and departed for Europe. Liberation, published in Stuttgart and smuggled back into Russia, became the rallying point for liberal mobilization in 1905. Thus, even before the revolution, Russia was equipped with a panoply of political associations dedicated to various degrees of radical change. All were illegal. The revolution itself, when it came, was not, however, a product of socialist agitation. It began not among the laboring masses, who had their own grievances and goals, but at the top of the social pyramid, from the halls of academe to the provincial zemstvos, the physicians and schoolteachers, the feminists, the high school and university students, and their lawyer fathers. All welcomed the occasion to challenge the regime and present their demands for inclusion in the political life of the empire, to realize their bid for civil rights and lawfulness. Many of them sympathized with the desire of the radical left for greater social equality and justice. The educated establishment's long-standing discontents were exacerbated by the consequences of the war with Japan, which began in February 1904. One Japanese victory followed another, and the empire's state-of-the-art battleships sank to the bottom of the Yellow Sea, the government's prestige sinking along with them. In the autumn of 1904, the same Zemstvo circles which had collaborated in creating liberation began, with the acquiescence of Plieva's less draconian successor, to organize congresses of Zemstvo delegates. By the end of the year, they had produced a list of demands for political reform. The aspirations of civil society gave the revolution its political shape and provided the initial momentum, but the anger of the popular classes gave it power. In 1903, the police had introduced a program of officially sponsored labor unions meant to steal the thunder from radical agitators. They were all too successful. In St. Petersburg, the Orthodox priest Father Georgi Gapon created the Assembly of Russian Factory and Mill Workers, Sobranie Ruskich Fabrichno, Zavodsky Rabochek, which grew to considerable proportions. The assembly had strong support, in particular at the massive Putilov machine building works, employing 13,000 workers. At the beginning of January 1905, the Putilov hands struck to protest the firing of four assembly members, and most of the city's factories soon joined them. In the tradition of humble petitioners, Gapon decided to present the Tsar with a list of the workers' demands. The language of socialism was absent, the posture was deferential, but the demands were nonetheless defiant. The eight-hour day and the right to unionize, but also the democratic franchise, civil liberties, and equality before the law. On Sunday, January 9, 1905, Gapon led a procession numbering tens of thousands of workers and their families, who headed for the Winter Palace, singing hymns as they went. At the Narva Gates, with its great triumphal arch marking Russia's entry into Paris in 1814, they were stopped by a mass of soldiers who opened fire on the crowd. Gapon made his escape, but other confrontations occurred that day at different points in the city, including in Palace Square outside the Winter Palace. In the end, 150 marchers were killed and at least 300 wounded. Bloody Sunday, as it was instantly dubbed, elicited an outpouring of public indignation and precipitated an avalanche of labour unrest and popular protest across the empire. Strikes spread through the cities, peasants torched manor houses, soldiers and sailors mutinied. On the one hand, the lower orders ran amok. On the other hand, organization was everywhere. The revolution was a festival of mobilization, broader than any of the clandestine plotters could instigate or control. The process of politicization affected associations across the board and engendered new ones. Craftsmen founded unions, professionals created a union of unions, Soyuz Soyuzov. Factory workers elected councils, and umbrella councils linked factories and neighborhoods to each other. The Russian word for council is Soviet, Soviut. When activists in St. Petersburg decided in October to establish a command center for the dawning proletarian revolution, they called it the Soviet of Worker Deputies, Soviet Rabochek Deputatov. Before that point was reached, however, attempts were made to resolve the growing crisis. In the effort to defuse the widespread labor unrest, in February, Nicholas summoned worker delegates to an advisory commission, chaired by the undistinguished bureaucrat Nikolai Shidlovsky. But when the delegates became too demanding, it was dissolved. The workers learned two lessons from the Shidlovsky Commission: the power of self-representation and the futility of playing by the rules. In June, the Zemstvo Constitutionalists, as they were now called, delegated the eminent religious thinker and professor of philosophy, Prince Sergei Trubetskoy, from one of the empire's oldest aristocratic families, to visit the Tsar and make the case for a modicum of reform. Nicholas offered vague promises, but only minor concessions were made. Meanwhile, the extremes of right and left contributed to the continuing turbulence. In February, Grand Duke Sergei Alexandrovich, the Tsar's uncle and the commander of the Moscow military district, was assassinated by the SR Ivan Kaliayev in retribution for the January massacre. Kaliayev was not Jewish, but anti-Semites blamed the Jews. Pogroms were numerous throughout the revolution, often the work of gangs known as Black Hundreds. Chernai Sotnye. A wave of pogroms had followed the assassination of Alexander II, and the pattern of blaming and attacking Jews at moments of social and political vulnerability became well established. Mob violence and common crime abounded, but ordinary people also displayed a capacity for purposeful collective action. Radical agitators provided slogans, the eight-hour day or the democratic franchise, but strikers focused mainly on achieving decent conditions, shorter hours, and better pay. In the context of revolution, all action acquired political meaning, and any form of mobilization, by definition illegal, was a challenge to authority. At the height of the spring strike wave, Minister of Finance Vladimir Kokobstov, in the spirit of the police-sponsored programme which had produced Father Gapon, proposed that labour unions be legalised, satisfying the workers' desire for self-representation and diffusing their anger. His suggestion was rebuffed, but officials closer to the action realised that organisation could be useful, and intransigence was a provocation. When in May massive strikes broke out in Ivanovo-Voznesensk, a textile manufacturing centre northeast of Moscow, the local factory inspectors suggested the strikers elect delegates to represent them. The Council of Worker Deputies that emerged was in effect the first Soviet, yet confrontation remained the norm. Before long, Cossacks were summoned to disperse an unauthorised mass meeting, leaving several of the strikers dead and provoking a burst of uncontrolled anger. Stones thrown, shops looted, policemen attacked. Eventually, the strike in Ivanovo-Voznesensk petered out, with little to show for it. Lenin had always been aware of the potential for spontaneous mass action, strikinost, to go awry, and the need to exert ideological control, sosnetelnost. A chapter of What is to be Done was devoted to attacking the hope for self-generated revolution. The strikes and grassroots organs of leadership produced in 1905 endowed the factory districts of the urban centres with a sense of power, but Lenin always focused on the ultimate goal of revolution, which was to replace one political system with another. The experience of 1905 developed habits of self-organisation that would be repeated, myths of heroism and sacrifice that would be remembered, but the goal was still out of reach. The outcome confirmed Lenin's suspicion of spontaneous mass movements. Yet spontaneous mobilization was the first revolution's gift to the revolution that followed a decade later. The experience of 1905 demonstrates that leaders are not enough and that violence itself is rarely devoid of form and purpose, however uncontrolled it may seem, and sometimes may be. The summer of 1905 was characterized by the continuing proliferation of organizations, failed attempts at compromise, and in August, the conclusion of peace with Japan, resulting in the Treaty of Portsmouth. The Russian delegation, headed by Count Witte, now chair of the Council of Ministers, a largely honorific position, included Konstantin Nabokov, the novelist's diplomat uncle. The Battle of Tsushima in May had destroyed two-thirds of the Russian fleet and undermined any lingering public support for the war. It seemed time for concessions. In July, liberal activists convened a gathering of representatives from city dumas, city councils, and zemstvos, in effect the spokesmen of civil society. The more cautious were still reluctant to make serious demands, but the majority formulated a programme that called for a constitutional monarchy, with a legislative assembly elected on the basis of the so-called four-tailed suffrage. Direct, equal, secret, and universal, though excluding women. Trying to check the momentum, in early August the government offered the model of a parliament with a limited mandate and a restricted franchise. Too little, too late. The summer was a period of growing ferment. University students had been on strike since the beginning of the year. At the end of August, the universities were granted autonomy, and the halls and classrooms filled with crowds of students, workers, activists, and ordinary citizens. The authorities seemed to think the continuous meetings in this rare arena for free speech would let off steam, but in fact the pressure only built up. The turning point came in September, when printers in Moscow went on strike, soon attracting other trades in which social democratic organizers had been active. A council of the five professions combined printers, carpenters, ribbon makers, tobacco factory workers, and railroad workers. These were not standard-issue proletarians, with nothing to lose but their chains. Indeed, even in large factories, skilled workers took the lead, but the model of worker representation was catching. The impact of labour action was powerful, not only because it was increasingly well organised, but also because it was part of the mobilisation of society across the board. In their self-designation as proletarians, workers were joining the civic community, a community that itself was taking form as authority at the top weakened. At the beginning of October, the funeral for Prince Sergei Trubetskoy, who in June had approached the Tsar with a plea for reform and had now suddenly died at the age of 43, drew a crowd of thousands, many sporting red flags. The next day, the Central Committee of the All-Russian Railroad Union, Sarasisky Isponitelny Komitet Zhelyezhnodorozhnoba Profsoyuza, shortened as VIGZHEL, established in April, announced the start of a railway strike, which by the next week had halted all traffic in Moscow, affecting the entire system. The railroad union was a particularly potent political instrument, uniting as it did ticket office clerks with skilled workers in repair shops and manual labourers serving the tracks, and extending its influence to the farthest reaches of the empire. A mass meeting at St. Petersburg University approved the call for a general strike, and the movement spread like wildfire. Every possible profession, waiters, pharmacists, bank clerks, theatre ushers, actors, ballet dancers, students, telegraph operators, and of course the industrial labour force, declared solidarity in every city and town. Trams stopped, lights went out. Industrialists collected money to support their employees. The Bolsheviks were not influential enough in the factories to have played a part in instigating the movement. If any party had an influence among the railroad workers, it was the SRs, who tended to appeal to white-collar employees. Once the strike was underway, the most important role was played by a group of St. Petersburg Mensheviks, who suggested that the factories elect representatives to a city-wide council, Soviet, of worker deputies. When the delegates convened in mid-October, they chose an executive committee, with a left-liberal lawyer as chair. Similar councils were formed in many cities. The Soviet had now acquired the political meaning it would transmit to 1917 as the tribute of the people, or the democracy, as it came to be called. The Bolsheviks stood aside. Lenin appeared in St. Petersburg only in November and was sceptical of the Menshevik idea. The Russian intelligentsia, whether respectable or confrontational, and the Russian proletariat, whether industrial or artisanal, were not the only players in the drama of 1905. If strikes peaked in January and February, and again from October to December, unrest in the countryside spiked in May, June and July, diminished during the harvest, then picked up again starting in October. Peasants lashed out at the landowners, taking grain, destroying property and financial records, and felling trees, but rarely harming the owners. They were expressing long-standing grievances, as well as protesting the impact of the military draft and the food shortages caused by a shortfall harvest. When it came to expressing political demands, that is, addressing themselves to power, they, like the workers, needed helpers. In this case, Zemstvo activists urged them to submit petitions, now welcomed by the authorities as a way to restore calm. Petitioning the higher-ups was a peasant tradition. What was new was the peasants' response to the chance to organize. In July and August, over 100 delegates arrived in Moscow province to form what was called the All-Russian Peasants' Union, Sarasisky Krestiansky Soyuz, guided in its deliberations by activists from the socialist parties. Whether the delegates knew what was meant by a constituent assembly is an open question. At the same time, as unrest continued, soldiers and police set fire to the guilty villages and punished suspected troublemakers with flogging, another imperial tradition. Peasants were important, moreover, not only in their communes and in the fields, but in uniform. The damage to the Tsar's image in the wake of Bloody Sunday and the continuing defeats in the Far East opened the door to defiance. To the discomfort of their commanders, troops were used to suppress domestic disturbances. In the general turmoil, it was unclear how long the soldiers would continue to follow orders. Protests might be infectious. Strikes on the railroad slowed the return of units from the Far East after peace was concluded. The Navy was now more volatile still, since crews included a high proportion of skilled technical hands recruited from the cities and therefore a potential source of political infection. Already in 1904, there had been signs of unrest. Most dramatic of all, and later dramatized in Sergei Eisenstein's 1925 anniversary film Battleship Potemkin, was the mutiny on the Black Sea Fleet battleship of that name in June 1905. Having gained control of the ship, the mutineers arrived at Odessa, where confrontations between strikers and Cossacks had been at fever pitch since the start of the month. Order was soon restored with the liberal application of gunfire. A crowd of civilians was mowed down as they descended the broad steps leading to the harbour. The slaughter provided the subject of one of the great scenes of modern cinema, as eyeglasses shattered and a baby carriage bumped its way down the stairs. The victims were an innocent, indeed bourgeois, public. There was no group in Imperial Russia that did not manifest some form of protest in the course of 1905. Even Orthodox seminarians expressed solidarity with the revolutionary movement. It is not surprising, then, that regions of the ethnic periphery should have been affected as well. Nicholas II's foreign minister, Count Vladimir Lambsdorff, himself of Baltic German descent, made the point in 1906. It was precisely the various allogenes, the Armenians, Georgians, Letts, Estonians, Finns, Poles, etc., who rose one after another against the imperial government for the purpose of obtaining, if not complete political autonomy, at least equal rights with the native population of the empire. The large portion of the former Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth incorporated into the Russian Empire at the end of the 18th century as a result of partitions with Prussia and Austria, known as the Kingdom of Poland, or Congress Poland, from 1815 to 1864, had long chafed at its subjugation. In 1830, and again in 1863, Poles launched major rebellions. Repression after 1863 had deepened Polish resentment. Anger erupted instantly in 1905. Warsaw and Lodz responded to Bloody Sunday with massive strikes. Troops answered with gunfire. Martial law was declared. In the Caucasus, Georgia experienced extensive peasant uprisings. In the Baltics, Reval, now Estonia's capital, Tallinn, was peaceful, but the industrial city of Riga, today the capital of Latvia, was overrun by strikes, which were met with armed repression. Latvian peasants directed their anger against the German landowners, who formed their own militias, but depended on imperial troops to finally restore order. The October general strike forced the monarchy to its knees. At the urging of Witte and Grand Duke Nikolai Nikolaevich, the Tsar's first cousin once removed, on October 17, Nicholas issued the manifesto that created the State Duma and promised the granting of civil liberties. The Duma would have the power to confirm all laws, thus implicitly limiting the monarch's power, but the principle of absolute rule was never formally abjured, leading to obvious tensions. Witte was named to head the new cabinet. His first appointment, of the reactionary Piotr Durnovo as Minister of the Interior, alienated the liberal figures whom he also invited to join. Durnovo's reputation alone, they felt, would nullify the promise of the new government. Contradictions were thus built into the October settlement from the start, but it was nevertheless an enormous achievement, opening the door to legitimate political participation and public debate. The new rules of the game allowed for the establishment of political parties, not formally legalized but accepted. The Union of Liberation, born of the journal Liberation, gave birth to the Constitutional Democratic Party. Konstitucyjna Demokratyczna Partia, also known as the Party of the People's Freedom. Partia Narodnej Svobody, for short, KDs or cadets. A party of professionals, with little resonance outside the urban elites and the zemstvo leadership, it couched among its leaders the historian Pavel Milyakov and Vladimir Nabokov, the novelist's father. The future author of Lolita was now 6 years old. A lawyer by training from a distinguished and wealthy aristocratic family whose own father had served as Minister of Justice under Alexander II and III, Nabokov Pere was a noted defender of Jewish rights and an outspoken opponent of the death penalty. His mother, as the novelist recalled, could not understand why her son, though he appreciated all the pleasures of great wealth, could jeopardize its enjoyment by becoming a liberal, thus helping to bring on a revolution that would, in the long run, as she correctly foresaw, leave him a pauper. The cadet stood for the rule of law, civil rights, civic equality, and protection of private property. On the key issue of increasing peasant access to land, they accepted the necessity for redistribution, but only with compensation to the present owners. Some even viewed constitutional monarchy as the best model for Russia. The cadet position, eminently moderate by European standards, expressed the desire of respectable society for an accountable system of power. The intransigence of the absolutist regime had pushed them, however, into alliance with the radical left, whose tactics, strikes, uprisings, even terror, they accepted during the revolution as a lever with which to advance their own moderate cause. Not all of them endorsed this alliance. The demarcation line between constitutional and revolutionary politics, observed Vasily Maklakov, divided the entire country and ran through the heart of the party as well. A pragmatist on the party's conservative right wing, Maklakov shared the constitutional persuasion. To the right of the cadets, but still within the liberal orbit, stood the Union of 17 October, Soyuz 17 Octibria, or the Octobrists, representing the interests of big business. If the cadets represented the middle class of culture and education, this was the real bourgeoisie, though many of its members earned their living as professionals, not unlike the cadets. The party's founder was Alexander Guchkov, from a wealthy Moscow merchant clan, where the cadets saw the October Manifesto as the first step toward further reforms. The Octobrists considered it an adequate basis for reformed monarchical rule. While endorsing civil rights and the legalization of trade unions, the businessmen did not share the cadets' ambivalent sympathy for the mass movement. They nevertheless shared the broad consensus among the educated public, demanding access to political power and greater accountability at the top. By contrast, ardent defenders of the autocracy, opposed to any kind of change, faced a dilemma. The sovereign had enacted reform by decree. To found a monarchist party was an oxymoron, yet the old principles needed a new defense. Despite their opposition to the Duma, some monarchists used it as a forum from which to attack the principle of parliamentary representation and impede its operations, a form of participatory sabotage. The extreme right also focused on the Jews, identified as the moving force of the revolution, a view shared in high places. The anti-Semitic Union of the Russian People, Soyuz Ruskova Naroda, received the Tsar's tacit endorsement. Nicholas agreed with Foreign Minister Lambsdorff, who remarked in January 1906 that the Jews figured as a specially active and aggressive element of the revolution, whether as individuals or as leaders of the movement, or in the shape of entire organizations. The manifesto broke the back of the revolution. Factories resumed work, parties held conventions. Euphoric crowds filled the streets in a sea of red flags. However, violence did not abate during the so-called Days of Freedom, but only intensified. In issuing the manifesto, the Tsar had confirmed his authority as the ultimate lawgiver, but the decree had, in theory, limited his power. The fact of conceding to pressure signaled weakness, not strength. In search of culprits, Black Hundred gangs sponsored by the Union of the Russian People assaulted pedestrians with a Jewish appearance, indeed anyone wearing eyeglasses. Across the empire overall, almost 700 pogroms were recorded, Almost 900 Jews were killed, many thousands were injured, and a vast amount of property was destroyed. The details were reported in the Russian press and damaged Russia's reputation abroad. The single most shocking incident occurred in June 1906 in the heavily Jewish city of Białystok in eastern Poland, in which 88 inhabitants were killed and 700 injured. Perpetrated in defense of authority, the pogroms were a symptom of the damage that authority had incurred and the desperation of the monarchy's defenders. Pogroms, of course, damaged authority even further, and though he shared Lambsdorff's diagnosis of the problem, Nicholas did not endorse the riots. The pogroms were not the only form of disorder that followed the October Manifesto. Peasants interpreted the decree as authorization to take possession of land they felt by rights was theirs. Rural unrest peaked in November 1905 and surged again between May and August 1906, this time often more deadly. Soldiers and sailors also kept the revolutionary spirit alive. Most dramatically, over 3,000 sailors on the Kronstadt naval base in the Gulf of Finland, across from St. Petersburg, rioted for 2 days at the end of October, demanding civil rights and better conditions, and plundering the town. Loyal troops brought them to order, leaving about 24 dead. The crews of 2 Black Sea Fleet warships stationed in the Crimean port of Sevastopol seized their vessels, presented demands, and persuaded the sympathetic Lieutenant Pyotr Schmidt to assume command. The government punished the malefactors and moved to institute reforms and expedite the demobilization of forces in the east. Confrontations escalated at the end of 1905, encouraged not only from the reactionary right, but from the radical left as well. The Soviets continued to function, operating as shadow municipal administrations. The St. Petersburg Soviet created its own militia and encouraged the workers to continue pressing their demands, including the 8-hour day. Bolsheviks and Mensheviks both believed that the fight was not yet over. Trotsky elaborated a theory of permanent revolution, designed to justify the premature, according to the Marxist timetable, advance to the proletarian phase. The reaction was not long in coming. The industrialists joined forces and imposed a coordinated lockout that left thousands of workers on the street. The regime meanwhile court-martialed the Kronstadt rebels and declared martial law in Poland. The Soviet riposted by calling another general strike, but the summons fell flat. The 8-hour day campaign and a post and telegraph strike also failed. Instead of backing down, the socialist leadership resolved on a final confrontation. It was a folie à deux. When the Soviet's chairman was arrested, it renewed its call for a general strike. This time, the entire executive committee and 200 delegates were arrested. Trotsky, then 26, was among those tried in September 1906. In February 1905, he had made his way undercover from Europe to the relative safety of Finland. Appearing in St. Petersburg in mid-October, he joined the Soviet leadership, but how much of a role he played is unclear. During the 15 months of his sentence, he studied and wrote, as he had during his first confinement, the classic luxury of revolutionaries in Tsarist prisons. After the St. Petersburg arrests, the action shifted to Moscow. The uprising that began in early December, complete with barricades and factory militias, demonstrated both the possibility and the futility of challenging the forces of order head-on. Workers in the factory district of Presnia acquired arms and ammunition. Cobblestones and furniture were piled into heaps blocking the streets. A massive strike shut off electricity and transportation. Institutions closed their doors. Residents panicked. By the middle of the month, the Semyonovsky regiment had arrived from Petersburg, and the Presnia district was subjected to heavy artillery bombardment. When it was over, at least 1,000 civilians had lost their lives, and hundreds had been arrested, many of whom were executed without trial. The extremism of the socialist parties which had pushed for insurrection was answered by the ferocity of repression. The public had been frightened by the continued radicalism of the St. Petersburg Soviet and by the aggressive tactics adopted in Moscow. Some liberals moved to the right, but in general the ruthless reprisals forfeited public sympathy for the post-manifesto regime. As the new year dawned, Vitter abandoned his earlier moderation for a concerted campaign of pacification. Punitive expeditions under military command went through the countryside, executing alleged rebels without trial and burning villages to the ground. Repression was particularly brutal in the Baltic provinces, where Prime Minister Durnovo gave General Vladimir Sukomlinov carte blanche to apply maximum force. Emergency laws went into effect in two-thirds of the empire. The crackdown was successful because the troops obeyed orders. Into 1906, soldiers mutinied sporadically, interpreting the Duma, as they had the October Manifesto, as a sign that supreme power had weakened, yet in the end the balance did not tip. While the government waged war on its own population, the extreme left also went on a rampage. Over the course of 1906, SR assassins succeeded in killing hundreds of officials and numerous bystanders in the process. The Bolsheviks, for their part, financed their own activities by robbing banks at gunpoint. Minister of the Interior Durnovo, meanwhile, purged the ranks of civil servants and professionals suspected of radical sympathies. The censorship, which had relaxed its hold during the upheaval, was now reinforced. Weathering periodic confiscations, satirical journals kept directing their barbs at the new regime, while canonizing the holy moments of the revolution, Bloody Sunday, and the Moscow uprising. Potent symbols were born. After the grand finale of 1905, the aftermath was anticlimactic. The Duma franchise was neither universal nor equal. The proportions favoured landowners over peasants and workers, in that order. Peasants nevertheless constituted the vast majority of the population, and it was hoped their traditional submissiveness would now return. The Bolsheviks and the Union of the Russian People, at the two extremes, agreed in their antagonism to the Duma. The Bolsheviks declared a boycott, but some monarchists took part in the campaign. The cadets came away victorious with 40% of the seats, while a quarter went to independents and another quarter to a string of left-wing parties. The Octoberists and other moderates emerged with a mere 3% of the seats, the radical right with none. Over half the deputies represented the peasantry, over a third the nobility, and about a fifth the urban professions. Before the deputies could convene in late April, however, Vitter, in a preemptive move, secured a large loan from France and other European powers, cushioning his government against the deficit created by the war and avoiding financial dependence on the Duma. The government also managed to retract or undermine some of the central promises of the October Manifesto. In February, the Tsar endowed the Ceremonial State Council, half of its members appointed by himself, with powers equal to those of the Duma. The cadets denounced the move as a coup d'etat. Then, 4 days before the Duma was scheduled to open, the fundamental laws of the empire were published. A constitution in all but objectionable name, these laws could be changed only by the emperor. The promised civil rights, due process, private property, various liberties, were limited by law. The scope of the Duma was also restricted. Laws could be passed by decree during its recess, in theory subject to later approval, and the Tsar was entitled to dissolve it. Milyakov called the fundamental laws a conspiracy against the people. Another change also altered the landscape, again before the Duma had even convened. 5 days before it opened, Vitter stepped down and was replaced by Ivan Goryamikin. 10 years Vitter senior, Goryamikin had been Minister of the Interior in the late 1890s. He was now appointed over the objections of his colleagues, who considered him inadequate to the job, describing him as rigid, retrograde, and lazy. In another move in the confrontational two-step between ruler and subjects, the Third Cadet Party Congress adopted a series of reform objectives for the coming session that were clearly unrealistic. These included land reform and an official investigation into government repression of the revolution. The day the Duma opened, soldiers and police were posted throughout the city, anticipating disturbances, but reluctant though he was, Nicholas had decided to demonstrate his imperial pleasure. The deputies were invited to the Winter Palace, where the Tsar pronounced a speech. Uniformed bureaucrats and courtiers in formal dress stood to one side. The deputies, from every corner of the empire and in every possible attire, stood to the other. The speech was lackluster, and so was the deputy's response. After the reception, they proceeded to the Tauride Palace, built in the late 18th century under the reign of Catherine the Great for her lover Prince Potemkin, now refurbished to accommodate the new assembly. The deputies were greeted warmly as they passed through the streets. The establishment of the Duma was supposed to have quieted the revolution, but it met against the background of persistent turmoil. Peasants were not cut off from events in the capital. Newspapers reporting on Duma debates reached villages already troubled by the consequences of a poor harvest and the return of demobilized soldiers. The deputies received thousands of petitions from the countryside, transcribed by schoolteachers, doctors, or clerks, but expressing genuine concerns. Despite the Bolsheviks' disdain for the elections, workers also showed an interest in the Duma. Lenin decided it was worth participating after all, if only to make trouble. The most difficult problem tackled by the first Duma was the question of land reform, but the most impassioned debate concerned the Białystok pogrom. Speakers focused on the discovery that a secret printing press within the Ministry of the Interior had been issuing pamphlets denouncing the Jews. The most arresting moment in the debate was the speech delivered by Prince Sergei Urusov, lately governor of Bessarabia province, where he had arrived in the wake of the 1903 Kishinev pogrom, shocking at the time for its ferocity. Urusov denounced the involvement of local officials in the riots and made a plea for the strict enforcement of existing laws against ethnic hatred and mob violence. His words, published in domestic and foreign papers, caused a sensation. After repeated provocations and mutual insults, barely 10 weeks after the Duma opened, the government decided it had to go. As troops massed in the capital, almost a third of the deputies retreated to the Finnish town of Viborg, Vipuri, sheltered from the police, where they formulated what came to be known as the Viborg Manifesto, titled To the People, from the People's Representatives. It called on the population to withhold taxes and defy military conscription. It was a foolhardy and inconsistent gesture. The cadets were once again playing with revolutionary fire, only this time there was no spark, and they soon realized their mistake. The signers were eventually brought to court, and 166 were sentenced to 3 months in prison. All forfeited the right to stand for re-election. At the end of July, Pyotr Stolypin, Goyemikian's Minister of the Interior, moved up to take his place. After Bitter, Stolypin was the most significant figure in the late years of the empire. From an old noble family, he had previously served as governor in the provinces of Grodno and Saratov. If Bitter had managed to settle the revolutionary earthquake with the October Manifesto, Stolypin had to face the aftershocks. He pursued a complicated strategy of sustaining the Duma while curtailing its powers and working around it. Beginning at the end of 1906, he also instituted a far-reaching program of rural reform designed to establish a solid landowning class in the countryside with an investment in stability, thereby also depriving the Duma of the initiative. Above all, he applied the strong arm of the state in repressing popular unrest and punishing challengers from the left, a difficult and self-contradictory program. despite the waning of the Soviets' charisma at the end of 1905, the disaster of the Moscow uprising, and the failure of the Vyborg Manifesto to elicit any kind of response, challenges to authority continued. In his first days in office, Stolypin confronted mutiny among the sailors in Kronstadt and the Helsingfors, now Helsinki fortress, of Sveaborg, as well as in Reval. In the cities, by contrast, mass action seemed on the decline. The St. Petersburg Soviet issued and then rescinded the call for a general strike, and its leaders were arrested. An echoing strike in Moscow quickly died down. The second half of 1906 was characterized, however, by a surge in terrorism from both left and right. In July, assassins paid by the Union of the Russian People murdered a cadet Duma deputy whom they believed to be Jewish. Mikhail Gertsenstein had in fact converted to Orthodoxy, but he had spoken out against the pogroms. His funeral drew a crowd of thousands. The perpetrators were tried and convicted, but pardoned by the Tsar, who sympathized with their mission. Stolypin thought it wiser, however, to relax the restrictions facing the Jews, which had been increasing since 1881, but the modest proposal he submitted for approval in October 1906 was rejected by Nicholas at the first urging of his inner voice. In March 1907, another cadet deputy from the First Duma, one of the signatories of the Vyborg group and a member of the League for Jewish Rights, was gunned down on a Moscow street. 20,000 people attended his funeral. The assassin, hired by the Union of the Russian People, escaped abroad. The SR, for their part, were also responsible for dramatic gestures. On a Saturday in mid-August 1906, Stolypin was receiving petitioners at his summer house on one of the islands in the Neva River when three men appeared wearing officers' uniforms and carrying suitcases. In a scenario all too familiar in our own day, the cases exploded, killing them and 27 other people and injuring 70, including two of Stolypin's children. He himself was barely hurt, his prestige enhanced by his composure. The deed was the work of an SR offshoot calling itself the Union of SR Maximalists, Soyuz SRF Maximalistov. This, and a persistent reign of terror from the left, led the government to institute field courts-martial, with the power to impose and execute summary sentences. Until allowed to lapse a year later, the courts applied the death penalty in over 1,000 cases and sentences of hard labour in over 300. In a seeming echo chamber of lawlessness, right and left pursued their common goal of impeding the emergence of a stable political system. Despite the disqualification of the Vyborg signatories, the Second Duma, which opened in February 1907, after a hiatus of 7 months, proved even more contentious than the first. The right elected its first deputies, the number of socialist seats rose, while the centre contracted. The cadets, however, had become more cautious. Stolypin offered formally to legalise the party, on condition it publicly repudiate left-wing terror. Milyukov entertained the proposition, but the party refused for fear of seeming to endorse Stolypin's courts-martial. The Octoberist party had split on that very issue. Overall, the chamber was deeply divided. Half its members opposed the Duma's very existence. In early March, Stolypin appeared before the assembly, in a conciliatory spirit, to outline his programme, including pending legislation on land reform. In reply, the Menshevik deputy from Georgia, Irakli Seretelli, half the minister's age, delivered a strident condemnation of his government. Seretelli was denounced from the floor by Vladimir Purishkevich, who soon became known for inflammatory speeches and vulgar anti-Semitic tirades. Stolypin maintained his dignity and refused to be provoked. Throughout April and May, the cadets persisted in offering plans for agrarian reform, more radical than anything the government was likely to accept. Outside the Duma, the government closed newspapers and widened the scope of arrests. each side reinforced its image of the other. As the tensions persisted, the police raided the apartments of the SD and SR deputies, charging the Social Democrats with sedition. The cadets condemned the group's expulsion. Maklakov, at the very right of his party and the least prone to political sentimentalism, explained to Stolypin that accepting the arrest of fellow deputies would sap the party's moral foundation. Stolypin had little room for manoeuvre. On Sunday, June 3, 1907, at the Tsar's insistence, notices were posted at the Tauride Palace, closing the Duma. Its president learned the news from a foreign journalist. Over the next few days, 600 people were arrested, including the SD deputies in question. In violation of the fundamental laws, the Duma franchise was adjusted by decree to reduce the representation of workers, peasants, and ethnic minorities, eliminating almost the entire geographic periphery. No protests ensued, but arrests continued, more newspapers were shuttered, and recently legalized trade unions were now repressed. Measures against continuing acts of terror and criminality intensified. The dissolution of the Second Duma and the alteration of the electoral laws were denounced as a coup d'etat. Stolypin was an authoritarian pragmatist. He had not hesitated to defy the recent, half-hearted, commitment to legality, but he still viewed the Duma as a useful instrument. He counted on the Third Duma, which opened in November, with its staunchly middle-of-the-road centre, to provide a workable base from which to enlist society in the project of stabilising the country through a combination of repression and reform. The public forces which had confronted the regime in 1905 could not simply be ignored. The Octoberists indeed now emerged in the Duma as the single largest party, which, together with other moderate groups, constituted a large majority. The cadets and far-right balanced each other at the edges, while the left had been severely reduced. Landowners held 40% of the seats. Some key figures survived the reshuffle. Purishkevich reappeared on the right, Milyakov and Maklakov among the cadets, and Guchkov for the Octoberists. Over the course of 4 years, however, Stolypin forfeited the advantage he had gained. His continual violations of the fundamental laws, combined with the Tsar's own blatant disregard for legality, alienated the Octoberist centre, and the party became a less reliable partner. Even Stolypin's sponsorship of Gukov in 1910 as Duma president did not guarantee support, nor did the extreme right mitigate its hostility to the Duma, despite the government funds supplied to the Union of the Russian People and to various reactionary newspapers. The dissemination of propaganda and targeted financial backing of the press were part of Stolypin's overall attempt to shape public opinion. Anti-Semitism was, of course, as much a force for disruption as the calls for class warfare coming from the left. Altogether, the courtship of reactionary forces did little to strengthen Stolypin's hand. Russia's diminished prestige in the international arena, its loss to Japan in 1905, and its failure to block the annexation of Bosnia by Austria in 1908, undermined Stolypin's position in conservative eyes. In belated reaction to the self-assertion of subject minorities in 1905, and in a gesture extended to frustrated Russian patriots, Stolypin took extra steps to curtail Finland's traditional rights and attempted to limit Polish influence in the western provinces. Along with official sponsorship of anti-Semitic extremism, the nationalist turn would have unfortunate consequences in the near future. Stolypin himself did not live to see the end of the Third Duma. On September 1, 1911, Nicholas was in Kiev for the unveiling of a monument to the emancipation of the serfs 50 years before. Stolypin was in the party that attended a performance of Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov's opera The Tale of Tsar Saltan in the Municipal Theatre. During intermission, a young man walked into the minister's lodge and shot him in the chest. As Stolypin collapsed into his seat, he cried, rather operatically, "I am happy to die for the Tsar," at which point Nicholas himself appeared in the box. 4 days later, Stolypin died of his wound. The assassin was 24-year-old Dmitry Bogrov from a wealthy Jewish Kiev family. Though he considered himself an anarchist, in 1907 he had become an informant for the secret police, reporting on the activities of the local SRs and SR maximalists, apparently for the money. When his comrades began to suspect a double cross, they insisted he prove himself by performing a spectacular act of terror. The Tsar's visit provided the opportunity. Bogrov chose Stolypin, not Nicholas, as his target. Having convinced the police that the minister needed protection, Bogrov was given a pass to the theatre on the night of the performance. After the shooting, he was taken away, court-martialed, and a week later hanged. Though Stolypin had said he was happy to die for the Tsar, by 1911 he no longer had the Emperor's wholehearted backing. His assassination spared him a final disappointment. In over 5 years in office, Stolypin had confronted three major challenges: to establish a working relationship with society, as represented in the Duma; to implement reforms that would change the face of the countryside and reduce the likelihood of peasant unrest; and to manage or counteract the influence of radical ideology on both left and right. He failed on all counts. The Third Duma remained troublesome. The reforms did not have time to produce results, and his support for the organized right had serious short- and long-term consequences. Nor did the threat of industrial turmoil disappear. Rather, the economic recovery that began in 1910 led to an upsurge in labor activism. A flashpoint came in spring 1912 at the Siberian gold mines on the Lena River, owned by a British-Russian joint stock company. When striking workers assembled to protest the arrest of their leadership, they were met by troops who opened fire, leaving over 200 dead and an equal number wounded. The Lena Goldfields Massacre, as it came to be known, an echo of Bloody Sunday, triggered a rash of strikes in St. Petersburg and Moscow, and the level of worker unrest rose to the highest point since the revolution. The Bolsheviks now turned their attention to the surviving labor unions, where they began successfully to compete with the Mensheviks for influence, establishing footholds in key industries. In the Fourth Duma, they won a majority of seats held by labor, another portent for the future. Duma deputy Alexander Kerensky, elected from the Socialist Laborite Party, Trudoviki, loosely associated with the SRs, headed an investigation of the Lena events, which was reported in the press. 11 years younger than Lenin, Kerensky was also born in Simbirsk, where his father was a school inspector. The two families were acquainted. After 1905, Kerensky made a name for himself in St. Petersburg as a defense lawyer in political trials. He became known in the Fourth Duma for his eloquent speech-making and emerged in February 1917 as the leading figure of the first months of the revolution. The Fourth Duma sat from November 1912 to summer 1913, returning from recess for a second sitting between October 1913 and June 1914, then for a special one-day convocation on July 26, 1914, August 8, New Style, to vote war credits. This assembly was characterized by even greater polarization and party fragmentation than the Third, where the Octoberists had been the mainstay. Now their numbers diminished, the cadets held their own, while the right and the left grew. Overall, the number of distinct groups and fractions had increased. Among the cadets, Maklakov and others on the right criticized Milyakov's leadership as unrealistic, while those on the left urged greater contact with the socialists and the workers' movement. Alliances emerged between progressive industrialists and the professional classes, united around several basic demands: opposition to the so-called June 3rd system, reform of the State Council, the defense of civil liberties, and the demand for a cabinet responsible to the Duma. But no effective opposition emerged. Not only was the Duma internally divided, but it faced a less united government under Stolypin's successor, Vladimir Kokovtsov, former Minister of Finance, now serving concurrently in that post. Stolypin's attempt to establish a working relationship with the Duma majority, with the Octoberist Party as key, was often foiled by his own actions. Kokovtsov had no such base because the parties had begun to fragment, and also because he did not have the same goal. Nicholas approved of the new Prime Minister's seeming disregard for politicking. His position was weakened, moreover, by obstruction from within his own cabinet. The most hostile and underhanded of its members was Nikolai Maklakov, the cadet Vasily Maklakov's younger brother, appointed Minister of the Interior in February 1913 over Kokovtsov's objections. For the rest of the year, Maklakov did everything in his power to undermine Kokovtsov's authority, urging Nicholas to reduce the Duma to advisory status, diminish the minister's collective responsibility, and reimpose preliminary censorship on the press. In short, Maklakov made his best attempt to undo the October Manifesto and restore autocratic power. Kokovtsov survived only to the end of January 1914, when he was replaced by the same Guryamikhin who had followed Vitter, in both cases representing a reversion to short-sighted bureaucratic civility. The emperor described the move with satisfaction as a coup d'etat. The entire right wing of the Duma, whatever its internal nuances, was united on the question of the Jews. Nicholas and Count Lambsdorff were not alone in blaming the revolution, the continuing socialist agitation, and the campaign of terrorist assassinations on this familiar scapegoat. Leading ministers such as Vitter, Stolypin, and Kokovtsov understood the dangers involved in encouraging the mob to strike out, even in defense of the Tsar and the Christian God. They understood that foreign opinion, aroused by news of pogroms, could damage Russia's reputation, and that cultivating the goodwill of international Jewish finance was a matter of national interest. Yet they were ambivalent and inconsistent on the question of removing existing limitations on Jewish residence, education, and public service. There were good reasons to think, for example, that confining the vast majority of the empire's 3.5 million Jews to the 15 southwestern provinces known as the Pale of Settlement and another 1.7 million to the Polish provinces contributed to Jewish poverty and encouraged Jewish radicalism. In early 1911, Stolypin seemed to give his approval to a bill introduced in May 1910 proposing the abolition of the Pale. A vote in February 1911 referred the bill to committee, where it subsequently died, but not before eliciting a lively debate on the Duma floor, in which Vasily Maklakov delivered an impassioned speech in favour not only of abolishing the Pale, but of equal rights for Jews. Meanwhile, in Kiev in March 1911, a Russian boy was found murdered. The local Black Hundreds declared the killing to have the markings of an ancient Jewish ritual, in which Christian victims were drained of their blood for use in matzos. At their urging, the Kiev police arrested an employee of a local brick factory by the name of Mendel Bayliss, a casually observant Jew who had until then enjoyed good relations with his neighbours. What began as a local case expanded into an international scandal by the intervention of Minister of Justice Ivan Sheglofitov, who gave the case a top-level imprimatur. After 2 years in prison, Bayliss appeared in a Kiev courtroom, where his trial lasted from late September to the end of October 1913. A jury of peasants heard government-backed witnesses and the testimony of experts asserting the nefarious character of the Jewish faith. They also heard speeches for the defense by a team of lawyers, Gentile and Jewish, mobilized by the Russian Jewish community, including Vasily Maklakov, who denounced the case as a sham and a disgrace to the Russian judicial system. The trial made front-page news in the Russian press and resonated around the world. The case became a rallying point for the enlightened Russian public, as the Dreyfus affair had been in France. The peasant jury in the end found Bayliss not guilty of the crime, but conceded that ritual murder was indeed a credible accusation. The Bayliss case was not the last scandal to blight the final years of Nicholas's reign. The defenders of monarchy, who refused to adapt to the demands of modern governance, contributed to the autocracy's undoing. But the monarchy depended not only on effective government, it depended also on the special sacred aura attached to the sovereign's person. Even before the end of the Third Duma, this glow had begun to dim. By 1911, public uneasiness with the Tsar's diminishing stature had begun to fixate on the figure of Grigory Rasputin. A Siberian peasant who had assumed the role of a wandering holy man, Rasputin came to St. Petersburg, where at the end of 1905 he caught the attention of the imperial couple and soon became a regular presence at court. His repute as a miracle worker or faith healer and his place in the Empress's affections were assured in 1912, when he seemed to cure her son, the Tsarevich, of a bout of haemophilic bleeding. Drawing around himself a circle of adoring women, he gained a reputation for sexual promiscuity as well as mystical gifts. He seemed both compelling and repulsive. The earliest objections to the uncouth figure, with his black cloak and piercing eyes, came not from the public, but from top officials. Stolypin and Kokovtsov both tried to get rid of him. In early 1912, Mikhail Rodzianko, the Octoberist leader who had succeeded Guchkov as president of the Duma in March 1911, warned Nicholas that Rasputin belonged to an illegal religious sect, the so-called self-flagellators, Klisti. There is no evidence that Rasputin was in fact anything but a magnificent egotist with powers of seduction, both spiritual and sexual. The charge of sectarianism was designed to discredit him, but it reflected the sinister threat he seemed to embody. For Nicholas, he was a messenger from the divine. For the anxious public, a devil. Rasputin, Rodzianko warned, is a weapon in the hands of the enemies of Russia, who use him to undermine the church and the monarchy. No revolutionary propaganda could achieve as much as the presence of Rasputin. A year later, with Rasputin still in place, Rodzianko proclaimed before the Duma, "You all know what a terrible drama Russia is living through. At the center of that drama is a mysterious tragicomic figure, like a shade of the underworld, or a survivor of the darkness of past centuries, a strange figure in the light of the 20th century." Clinging to Rasputin in their isolation from society and even from the government, the imperial couple distanced themselves further, not only from the public, but from their loyal servitors as well. Ceremonies marking the centenary of Romanov rule that kicked off in February 1913 did nothing to restore the court's luster. As historian Richard Wertmann remarks, rather than provide an occasion for consensus, the celebration became a focus of contention between diverse understandings of nation, liberal, statist, monarchical, and clerical. Again asserting his divinely inspired mandate, the Tsar rode from the Winter Palace to the Cathedral of Our Lady of Kazan on Nevsky Avenue. Police and troops were on the alert for revolutionary demonstrations or a terrorist attack. Anti-Semitic monarchist organizations, including the Union of the Russian People, were prominent in the procession, signaling the Tsar's approval. As Wertmann notes, the religious processions had taken on the aspect of a political demonstration in behalf of the Tsar. The elected representatives of the people, the unwanted intermediaries between the Tsar and his folk, as Nicholas saw them, were demonstratively pushed to the side. The Tsar's manifesto omitted mention of the Duma. Rodzianko was slighted at the official banquet. In May, the imperial couple toured central Russia, ending their ceremonial journey in Moscow. Visits to holy sites and audiences with humble peasants provided the message of enduring tradition and closeness to the people's heart. But incidents of discord with spokesmen of educated society marked the Tsar's distance from forces trying to lead Russia into the future. Spectacle was not enough to reconstitute dynastic authority in the modern world. It was a sign of how far the monarch's credit had sunk that the well-to-do middle classes now despaired of the political compromise they had earlier embraced. In November 1913, Guchkov expressed regret that the Octoberist Party's attempt to achieve a rapprochement with the government, the attempt at a peaceful, painless transition from the old order to the new, has failed. It was the Octoberists' duty, he now said, to defend the state system against the government itself. Opposition could no longer be relegated to the radical left, allowing the ministers to claim they were fending off a revolutionary cataclysm. In actual fact, said Guchkov, the government was resisting the fulfillment of the most moderate and elementary demands of society. The Octoberists must use every legal means to defend the government's authority against the very holders of office. In December 1913, Rodzianko complained to Nicholas that the country was in danger, not from the masses, but at the top. Each minister has his own opinion. For the most part, the cabinet is divided into two parties. The State Council forms a third, the Duma a fourth, and of your own opinion, the country remains ignorant. This cannot go on, Your Majesty. This is not government, it is anarchy. In short, the governing system established by the October Manifesto, which attempted to reconcile the principle of autocracy with parliamentary power and a unified cabinet, was in dire straits well before the onset of war in August 1914. Part 2. The Great War. Imperial Self-Destruction. 1. The Great War begins. The fighting in Europe lasted from August 1, 1914 to November 11, 1918, just over 4 years. For Russia, it lasted only until December 15, 1917, December 2 old style, just over 3. By then, the autocracy had collapsed and the regime that replaced it had fallen. The February and October revolutions of 1917 drew their explosive potential not only from the grueling experience of battle and home front privation, but also from the not-so-distant experience of the 1905 revolution. What follows is not a history of Russia's war, but a rumination on three themes that bear on the question of what form of politics and what kind of state emerged from the revolutions of 1917. The first theme concerns the disarray at the highest reaches of power in the monarchy's last years, the fact that authority was already compromised in 1914. The second addresses the patterns of violence that emerged during the fighting and persisted into the Civil War. Extreme brutality, at the front and behind the lines, sometimes enjoyed the sanction of authority, sometimes reflected authority's collapse. The third theme involves the stigmatizing of designated groups, different at different times and in different places, but united by exclusion from the common fold. Together, the weakness of authority, the suspension of moral restraint, and the deepening of social divisions prepared the ground for the ruthless struggle to reassert, control, and rechannel the volatile forces released by the war, the struggle that lasted 4 years, from 1917 to 1921, longer than the war itself. Russia did not enter the war from a position of strength. Some historians have argued that it was precisely the empire's internal weakness that prompted German leaders in summer 1914 to provoke the conflict. Russia enjoyed the advantage over Germany in manpower and natural resources, but these were not yet fully exploited. Both sources of vulnerability, domestic instability, and the still unrealized industrial and military potential were recognized by Russian statesmen at the time. Certain conservative figures in particular doubted Russia's capacity to survive more than a few months of war. They feared Germany was too powerful for Russia to handle. The diplomatic horizon was unquiet as well. Russia's humiliation in the Bosnian crisis of 1908 was still fresh, and the treaty concluding the Second Balkan War was barely a year old. The educated public was well aware of trouble still brewing in the Balkans and greeted the crisis of July 1914 with apprehension. High-ranking officials were divided on whether Russia's best interests lay in maintaining good relations with Germany or countering German influence by an alliance with France. The Russian Foreign Office heard reports that antagonism to Russia was increasing in Berlin. In the winter of 1913 to 1914, Germany sent a military mission to the Ottoman Empire under General Otto Liman von Sanders. Achieving control of the Turkish Straits, linking the Black and Aegean Sea, was a long-standing goal of Russian foreign policy. Russian diplomats interpreted the mission as Germany's attempt to establish its own influence there. This was the context in which Pyotr Dernobo, arch-conservative minister of the interior in the aftermath of the October Manifesto, warned Nicholas against weakening the German alliance. The opinions he expressed in a memo to the Tsar in February 1914 have often been cited as a bellwether of the disaster that ensued. Dernobo belonged to a group of far-right conservatives in the State Council who favoured the alliance with Germany as a matter of political principle. They were staunch supporters of unlimited monarchy and regarded the Duma with open distaste, as an institution created under duress and better to have been avoided. Russia and Germany, in Dernobo's words, represented the conservative principle in the civilized world as opposed to the democratic principle, incarnated in England and to an infinitely lesser degree in France. It was unfortunate that Nicholas had abandoned Russians' traditional friendly relations based upon ties of blood with the court of Berlin and drawn closer to England. A European war, Dernobo predicted, would involve Russia, France and England on the one side, with Germany, Austria and Turkey on the other. Russia, he feared, was not ready for this confrontation. Nicholas did not share his pessimistic view, but it reflected widespread anxiety about Russia's ability to withstand the domestic consequences of another war. Liberals in the Duma supported an alliance with England and France for the opposite reasons, as the progressive Western model to which Russia should aspire. Dernobo blamed them for the outbreak of revolution in 1905, when their democratic illusions, he believed, had played into the hands of unscrupulous firebrands. Should Russia be defeated in another war, these same liberals would again open the door to massive social upheaval. Inspired by socialist slogans, peasants would demand the division of land and property, and the defeated army, depleted of its best men, would find itself too demoralized to serve as a bulwark of law and order. The elites, having forfeited their authority, would be powerless to stem the popular tide aroused by themselves, and Russia will be flung into hopeless anarchy, the issue of which cannot be foreseen. Not all conservatives shared Dernobo's preference for the German alliance. Not all were uniformly hostile to the Duma. The lack of coherence among figures at court and high-ranking officials was a symptom of the regime's increasing weakness. Those who distrusted the Duma failed to understand the need to win its support, and thus the endorsement of respectable society, in the face of the very threats Dernobo so presciently detailed in February 1914. His colleague in the State Council, Baron Roman Rosen, a Baltic German of Orthodox faith, also feared the destructive consequences of war with Germany, but he saw the domestic challenge differently. The real danger of revolution, he noted in January 1914, is created not by the utopian demands of extreme radicalism, but by the failure to give timely satisfaction to the moderate desires and expectations of educated society, the higher social classes of any nation, which in their great majority have always been loyal. By summer 1914, however, public opinion, as well as many in the officer corps and key figures at court, had turned against Germany. Foreign Minister Sergei Sazonov stressed Russia's interest in maintaining Ottoman control of the Turkish Straits as crucial to Russian shipping and to keeping Germany from establishing its influence there. Nor could Russia stand by when Austria reacted to nationalist challenges in the Balkans. German support for Austrian interests was sure to follow. Nicholas opted for the alliance with England and France. Russia soon found itself in exactly the position Dernobo had outlined, with the consequences he and Baron Rosen had foreseen. The political incongruity of Russia's alliance with France was all too apparent. French President Raymond Poincaré visited St. Petersburg in late July, as the pre-war crisis was coming to a head. The French ambassador Maurice Paléologue described the pomp and ceremony of the imperial court as reflected in the precious gems glistening on the well-tended bosoms of the ladies in attendance. Russia, in his view, was an opulent and barbaric vestige of an historic moment the West had already surpassed, but its primitive might was needed to restore the balance of power against the German menace. Poincaré, together with Paléologue and the French Prime Minister René Viviani, were escorted to the Peter Paul Fortress, bastion of Tsarist oppression, by terrifying, red-coated Cossacks, as the Marseillaise answered to the Russian imperial hymn, God Save the Tsar. It might seem to a connoisseur of irony, Paléologue observed, as though Poincaré and Viviani, those avowed revolutionaries, were being led to their prison cells. Never had the moral contradiction, the tacit ambiguity at the heart of the Franco-Russian alliance struck me so forcibly. This was not the only paradox generated by geopolitical concerns. Insofar as liberals in the Duma were anti-German and pro-British, they also defended Russian ambitions in the Balkans and in the Straits, where German and Russian interests collided. This posture would get them into trouble in 1917, when they continued to endorse the monarchy's expansionist vision. The prosperous bourgeoisie, represented in the Octoberist Party, had long supported Russian imperial designs in the Balkans. The Octoberists had advocated a more aggressive Russian stance in the various crises since 1908. By the summer of 1914, the Russian public was primed for confrontation with Germany in this very arena. The fatal events followed in quick succession. On June 28, Archduke Franz Ferdinand of Austria was assassinated in Sarajevo. A month later, on July 23, Austria-Hungary presented Serbia with an ultimatum. On July 25, July 12, old style, Nicholas ordered that preparatory steps be taken to support the anticipated mobilization. On July 28, Austria-Hungary declared war on Serbia. Nicholas gave orders to mobilize the four military districts from which an attack on Austria would originate. On July 29, July 16, old style, Sazonov concluded that full mobilization must go forward. Nicholas at first agreed, but changed his mind that evening upon receipt of a telegram from his cousin, Kaiser Wilhelm II. The following morning, General Nikolai Yanushkevich, the Army Chief of Staff, and Minister of War Vladimir Sukhomlinov, with the endorsement of Mikhail Rodzianko, President of the State Duma, urged the Tsar to take the necessary steps, but he waited until later that day, after meeting with Sazonov, before finally issuing the order to proceed with general mobilization. The announcement came on July 31, July 18, old style. On August 1, 1914, July 19, old style, Germany declared war on France and Russia. By the following day, the German troops had crossed into Russian Poland. A day later, August 3, they invaded neutral Belgium. Britain declared war on Germany on August 4. On August 6, July 24, old style, Austria-Hungary declared war on Russia. The Great War had begun. The participants embarked on this conflict with foreboding. Even the German ambassador to St. Petersburg, Count Friedrich Portales, acted with obvious reluctance. After meeting with Sazonov on July 30, July 17, old style, Paléologue noted the ambassador looked haggard and seemed unsteady on his feet. The diplomats felt powerless to break the descent into war. Individual initiative has disappeared, Paleologue had bemoaned 3 days earlier. No act of will, no diplomatic move could stop the automatic mechanism set in motion. He reports the Austrian ambassador, Count Friedrich von Sapari, muttering, "La machine rule." After Portales presented the Kaiser's declaration of war to Sazonov, the ambassador burst into tears. It was perhaps self-serving of Paleologue to present his diplomatic confrères as helpless in the face of events. By the end of July, they no doubt felt that war could not be avoided. Nonetheless, decisions were being made. Nicholas had hesitated, but his ministers and the patriotic enthusiasts in the Duma had urged him on. Faced with the German and Austrian challenge, the Empire had no choice, they felt, but to defend its position as a great power or cease to be one. Military reforms implemented in response to the Balkan crises of 1908 and 1912 had strengthened the army. Continuing industrial growth and the extension of the railroad network provided grounds for cautious optimism. In July 1914, Russian ministers imagined the war would be short. It remained unclear, however, how the populace would respond to another military call-up a decade after the Russo-Japanese War, and whether the educated classes, represented in the Duma and in public organizations, would rally to the cause. As Rodzianko had warned Nicholas at the end of 1913, the Tsar might want to consider himself all-powerful, but the government was in fact dangerously divided. In August 1914, the regime's intentions were all too obvious, pitting the army against the cabinet and the cabinet against itself. On the side of reaction were Guryamikhin, chair of the Council of Ministers, now 74, and the obstructionist Minister of Internal Affairs, Nikolai Maklakov. Throughout the first half of 1914 and into 1915, Maklakov continued to urge that the Duma be reduced from a legislative to a consultative body, a campaign he had launched in 1913, equally in vain. On the relatively moderate side were the ministers who recognized the need to work with respectable public opinion. Sazonov had been Minister of Foreign Affairs since 1910, and his replacement in July 1916 by Boris Stürmer, at the time doubling as Prime Minister, was correctly perceived by the public as the triumph of reaction. Alexander Kryboshin, Minister of Agriculture since 1908, played a key role in the wartime cabinet as a voice of reason. He lasted in office until October 1915. Minister of War Sukhomlinov is hard to classify. His career illustrates some of the tensions within the autocratic system that threatened its own survival. A veteran of the Russo-Turkish War of 1877 to 1878, Sukhomlinov was promoted to general in 1898. He spent the turbulent years from 1899 to 1907 in Kiev, a hotbed of radical antisemitism, an outlook he shared, where he served first as chief of staff of the military district, becoming its commander in 1904. In 1906, he was charged with pacification of the Baltic provinces. In 1908, he was promoted to head the general staff in St. Petersburg. After 1905, the general staff had been separated from the Ministry of War, to which it was once again subordinated in 1909, the year Sukhomlinov became Minister of War, combining the two functions. Sukhomlinov was ambitious and venal. In the clientelist manner of the Tsarist bureaucracy, he promoted men loyal to himself, who were not always the best qualified. Yet in the wake of the Balkan crisis of 1908, he instituted a number of military reforms, which emphasized the role of technology, reconfigured the size and number of military units, and challenged the traditional use of cavalry and the defensive reliance on fortresses. Disliked by the Duma, he nevertheless gained its support for increased military spending. The revision of strategic planning and projects for more extensive military reform intensified after 1912, but not enough had been accomplished by 1914. Russia was still deficient in automatic weaponry and under-equipped with vehicles and airplanes. Railroads were still inadequate, and plans had not been made for a long war. The command still relied heavily on bayonets and fortresses. The reforms, moreover, were resisted by the upper-class officer corps, and in particular by the elite guard officers, first among them Grand Duke Nikolai Nikolaevich, who resented Sukumlinov's desire to control finances and appointments, and his challenge to traditional tactics and hierarchies. Since the autocracy was, by definition, a system of personalities and personal politics, the fact that Sukumlinov's career had won him enemies was nothing remarkable in itself. Such personal conflicts, however, amplified the administrative tensions between the Ministry of War and the military chain of command, at General Headquarters or Stavka, seated in the Belarusian city of Mogilev. These tensions were accentuated by the Regulations on the Field Administration of the Army in Wartime. Положение о полевом управлении войск в военное время, issued on July 16, 1914, old style. The regulations granted the Commander-in-Chief unfettered power in the theatre of military activity, defined as occupied territory and areas behind the front, creating a virtual second government free from civilian interference. The fracturing of authority was evident also in the appointment of Grand Duke Nikolai Nikolaevich to this position, a choice considered by some to detract from the Tsar's own status. As one general remarked, "You can't tear the feathers from the monarch's crown and distribute them to right and left. Supreme Commander, Supreme Evacuation, Supreme Council, all supreme, only the monarch is nothing." In short, the Tsarist regime approached August 1914 with a seriously disunited cabinet and military command. It encountered a war that straddled modernity and tradition, relying on automobiles, railroads and airplanes, of which Russia had a miserable few hundred, telephones and bugles, machine guns and sabres, horses and carts. It was a war that affected society from top to bottom and demanded its full engagement, under a regime used to seeing civic initiative as a threat rather than a resource. The public mood was therefore of great importance. In the days before Austria's ultimatum to Serbia, widespread strikes had seized St. Petersburg's largest factories. The authorities blamed them on German agents. By the time the order for general mobilization was announced, however, enthusiasm could be detected even in the working-class districts. Cheering crowds gathered in front of the Winter Palace and the Cathedral of Our Lady of Kazan. Educated society rallied to the flag. Duma President Rodzianko declared the conflicts plaguing Russian society since 1905 to be now forgotten. Socialists, by contrast, predicted a social cataclysm, like Dernovo, but for opposite reasons. In the short term, nevertheless, they urged their followers to accept the draft, on the grounds that war would prove the regime's undoing. They too, like Dernovo, were prescient. Mobilizing the monarch's symbolic resources, Nicholas announced the declaration of war on July 20, August 2, new style, at a ceremony in the Winter Palace that displayed the court in all its opulent glory. A massive crowd gathered on the embankment alongside the palace, Ambassador Paleolog reported, while officers and courtiers in fancy dress assembled inside. A mass was held around an icon of the Virgin Mary of Kazan, chants were sung, and the chaplain read aloud the Tsar's manifesto to his people. Slowly, clearly, echoing the words pronounced by Alexander I in 1812, Nicholas then declared, "Officers of my guard here present, I salute in you my entire army, and I bless you. I solemnly swear that I will not conclude peace so long as a single enemy remains on the soil of the fatherland." The crowd in the room and the crowd outside broke into frenetic cheers. Meanwhile, people streamed past the French embassy, chanting "Vive la France!" French observers assumed they had been recruited by the police. More spontaneous, perhaps, but also more ominous, was the attack on the German embassy on St. Isaac's Square. 2 days after the Tsar's announcement, a mob of several thousand destroyed the entire edifice as police stood idly by. The building, purchased in 1873, soon after German unification, struck Ambassador Paleolog as a provocation. A redesigned facade of Finnish granite in neoclassical style was unveiled in January 1913, in time for the Romanov centenary. Its 14 columns and the two bronze horses mounted on the roof seemed to the Frenchman ponderously Teutonic, powerfully symbolic of Germany's intention to dominate Russia. Similar outbursts occurred in provincial cities at the start of the war. Targeting symbolic objects, the people's wrath acquired symbolic status of its own. The neo-Orthodox religious philosopher Vasily Rozanov, a stringer for the vehemently anti-German Novoye Vremya, Modern Times, celebrated the impulse behind the attack. "Illusions are as sacred as facts," he remarked. "The dear people of Petersburg spent a splendid night of illusions, and God bless them." The liberal press, by contrast, likened the rampage on St. Isaac's Square to the Germans' own Teutonic vandalism. St. Petersburg's liberal mayor, Count Ivan Tolstoy, denounced the riot as hooliganism, a poisonous byproduct of officially sponsored patriotic demonstrations. Tolstoy was a black sheep, a man of enlightened views who rejected what he described as the routine prejudices of his milieu. He was outspoken in defense of the Jews and condemned the government's criminal nationalistic policies of the last 25 years. Yet even he was affected by the melodramatic tone of stories focused on German barbarity. A favorite theme concerned the fate of Russians caught by the outbreak of war on German soil. Ladies unceremoniously stripped to their underwear, patients taking the waters in German spas, dumped unceremoniously in railway stations. The bestial conduct, as Tolstoy put it, of the savage Teutonic barbarians. When in return, Russian authorities began summarily expelling long-time German residents from the capital, the mayor nevertheless bravely came to their defense. Tolstoy's own use of patriotic formulas shows how hard they were to resist. Such clichés included not only the image of the Teutonic barbarian, the beast lurking beneath the thin membrane of German culture, but also the obsession with German influence in Russian domestic affairs. Violence, nasili, in the one case. Domination, zasilia, in the other. Not only did Russia depend on German investment and trade, but for generations the Baltic German nobility had played a central role in Russian official and military life. Among the commanders in this war were Generals Pavel von Rennenkampf, Alexei Evert, Pavel Plebia, and Baron Anton Zaltz. Beginning in 1916, the Prime Minister and Minister of the Interior was Boris Stürmer. In November 1915, the Chief Procurator of the Holy Synod, Vladimir Karlovich Sabler, legally changed his name to Desiatovsky. In August 1915, Rennenkampf converted from Lutheranism to Orthodoxy. Such figures made easy targets. A certain general, Alexander Preece, for example, received an anonymous letter in May 1915 denouncing him as a spy. Many imperial administrators in Russian Poland had German names, opening them to suspicion and resentment among the Poles. As if practicing a belated exorcism, Nicholas thought in December 1916 of replacing the ubiquitous German terms for positions at court with Slavic equivalents. On August 18, old style, St. Petersburg was renamed Petrograd to Slavicize the Germanic form. If crowds thronged the streets and squares of Petrograd and other cities, seemingly moved by patriotic emotion, the villagers had no cause for joy. At the beginning of August 1914, approximately 1.4 million men were already in uniform. By the end of the year, another 5 million had been called up. Men over the age of 21, as recorded in the parish registers, were liable to be drafted. In the villages, account was taken of the number of working men in a household. In the cities, munitions factory workers and policemen were exempt. In 1915, an additional 5 million were drafted. In 1916, a further 3 million. In 1917, 730,000 more. By the time the war ended in 1917, 15,378 men had been conscripted, almost 40% of males between 15 and 49. The proportion of working-age men affected was higher in the villages than in the cities, and higher close to the front than in the interior. Peasants made up 85% of the overall population, and an even higher proportion of soldiers in the army. Soldiers served together with men drawn from their own areas, but the units were stationed far from home. As a form of preemptive counterinsurgency, Polish conscripts were not stationed in Poland. Just as critical to the peasant economy as the loss of labouring men was the procurement of horses and draft animals. Peasants were ordered to bring their horses for veterinary inspection, while the more delicate mounts of the neighbouring gentry were spared. The military equine census of 1912 recorded over 17 million horses. During the war, the army requisitioned over 1.5 million, or 10% overall, but over one quarter of agricultural workhorses. The peasants also lost many of their carts, and privately owned automobiles were requisitioned. "The war may be popular in the cities," a letter writer from Smolensk province observed, "but the villagers are horrified." When they called up the horses, the cheating was indescribable. "I didn't care because my horses were reserved, but it was unpleasant to watch." The departure of men from the countryside was a serious blow to the welfare of families and villages. Most complied, but some evaded the summons. The farewell drinking spree was a traditional peasant response to the draft. In 1904, drunkenness had disturbed the orderly call-up for the war against Japan. This time, the declaration of general mobilization was accompanied by prohibition on the sale of alcoholic beverages outside first-class restaurants and clubs, another sign that sacrifice was not to be spread evenly. The ban was extended at the end of August to last the duration of the war. Prohibition did not prevent recruits in many cases from breaking into liquor depots and indulging in drink-crazed mayhem. Not all the disturbances were fueled by drink. The call-up provoked rioting across Russia. In the cities, police patrolmen were attacked. In the villages, peasants set fire to estates and large farms. Food shops everywhere were looted. A riot in the Ural towns of Barnaul caused extensive damage to shops and dwellings, leaving 100 dead by the time the police restored order. The disorders that accompanied the draft did not necessarily reflect a principled opposition to the war, however. Conscription had not been announced in advance or explained in terms that made sense to the peasants, who in August were busy with the harvest. The provinces were undermanned with police. The cities were overwhelmed with the influx of peasant recruits. Nevertheless, with few exceptions, factory workers expressed patriotic views. Despite the numerous outbursts, people in the capitals had the impression that mobilization had gone smoothly. Once the war began, violence became a matter of organization, not rage or dismay. Casualty figures rose steeply. Manpower shortages were felt as early as the end of 1914. In 1915, Russia suffered a staggering 3 million casualties, dead, wounded or captured, and the draft age was lowered from 21 to 19. Casualties into 1917 have been estimated at over 6 million. Exact numbers are impossible to ascertain, but overall, 3 million inhabitants of the Russian Empire are thought to have lost their lives between 1914 and 1917 as a result of the war. The total includes almost 2 million soldiers who were killed in battle, succumbed to wounds, or died in captivity. A third of the 1 million civilian deaths resulted from military operations, the rest from hunger and disease. When it came to battlefield deaths, however, no class was exempt. The pre-war professional officer corps was decimated in the early months, opening the door to promotions from below and shifting the military's class profile. In round figures, the active officer corps in August 1914 consisted of about 40,000 men. The same number were mobilized right away, and another 220,000 were trained during the war. Of the total 300,000 who fought between 1914 and 1917, 24,000 were permanently lost, killed, incapacitated, or unaccounted for, leaving about 276,000 at the end of 1917, including 38,000 prisoners of war and severely wounded. Peasants became non-commissioned officers. The proportion of noblemen dwindled. Even before the war, the lower ranks of the officer corps had offered a path to social advancement. Now the process accelerated at the cost of training and competence. In 1905, non-commissioned and educated reserve officers had helped politicize the ranks. This happened again as the war progressed. Since Jews could not be officers, they were often the best educated men among the troops and thus played a disproportionate role in 1917. The loss of well-trained officers with an ethos of service had dire consequences for the army's ability to sustain morale and accomplish its military mission. The greatest burden of sacrifice fell, however, on the peasant masses, and no doubt the absence of good leadership contributed to a tremendously high casualty count. Conscripts may have submitted to the draft with fatalism or repressed resentment, but in an age of media-driven propaganda, submission was not enough. The urban public, even the factory masses, responded to the Tsar's appeal, but sentiment in the villages was harder to interpret. Educated people doubted whether peasants understood the purpose of the war or were capable of patriotic feeling. Officers viewed the ordinary man in uniform as simple and childish, guided by rituals and symbols, the mystical formula for faith, Tsar, and fatherland, rather than ideas or political principles. But undereducated people, no less than their social superiors, also needed reasons to fight. They maintained their own catalogue of meanings inherited from the past. Fyodor Stepan was a writer and philosopher of mixed Orthodox and German parentage, trained in the reserves, who served at the front as a junior officer. He recorded his impressions at the time and later recalled the attitudes of the men under his command. The troops were not indifferent to the meaning of the war, he observed. They were curious to know how it started and whether the Germans were baptized or unchristian like the Turks. The men were astounded to learn that the enemy was in fact Christian and not an infidel like the Turks and Japanese in earlier wars. Their conception of the war as a crusade was supported, Stepan supposed, on the one hand by sermons about the pious emperor and the Christ-loving host, and on the other by soldiers' songs tied to memories of the Turkish campaigns. Siberian peasants did not have an educated person's perspective on Russia as an empire or the geopolitical laws governing its existence. They did not see beyond the concerns of planting and harvests. Nevertheless, Stepan reported, despite their civic unpreparedness for war, the brigade fought gallantly. The Germans soon emerged in wartime propaganda as no less bestial and uncivilized than the Turk, despite the veneer of Western culture. Anxiety about the formidable German colossus was magnified by the fact that the enemy was an invader. Russia had not faced an invader since 1812, when Napoleon had set his sights on Moscow. Russia, now as then, had a long western border running from the Baltic to the Black Sea. Its most vulnerable extremity, surrounded on three sides by Prussia and Austria-Hungary, was the Polish territory west of the Vistula River. Anticipating the outbreak of hostilities, the authorities ordered the evacuation of personnel, official records, and even local garrisons from the entire region, which was left to fend for itself. Indeed, on July 20, August 2 New Style, German troops crossed the unguarded border and seized the towns of Kalisz, Częstochowa, and Benzin. Major General Sir Alfred Knox, the British military attaché, considered these trans-frontier raids to be of little importance. The impact of the German incursion was not military, however, but psychological. In the course of the next 2 weeks, German troops reduced the centre of Kalisz, a major textile centre and one of the oldest Polish cities, to ash and rubble, slaughtered many of its inhabitants, and caused others to flee in panic and terror. People were torn from their homes and gunned down in the streets, rabbis and priests taken hostage, corpses left on the pavement to rot, and physicians threatened at gunpoint. The hospital was damaged in artillery fire, and entire city blocks were set aflame. Indeed, the invading Germans treated Kalisz much the way they treated the Belgian city of Louvain 2 weeks later, causing a worldwide outcry. Stories of the devastation in Kalisz, relayed to Russian journalists by traumatized refugees, set the tone for propaganda fixated on enemy brutality and the uncivilized conduct of war. For Russians, Kalisz became, like Belgium in the West, a symbol of German savagery. The atrocity theme remained a persistent feature of wartime propaganda, but was especially intense in the first months. A group of German intellectuals publicly defended the war as a campaign against Russian barbarism. Among them were several former and future Nobel Prize winners, including the physicist Max Planck and the playwright Gerhard Hauptmann. In Russia, writers and artists suppressed whatever ambivalence they might have felt toward the imperial regime or toward war in general. They accepted the view that Russia had entered the conflict only in response to German provocation. The description and condemnation of so-called atrocities encouraged intelligentsia patriotism. Accounts of the Belgian horrors and the sack of Kalisz also acquainted the reading public and the populace that absorbed rumours and second-hand news with vivid descriptions of extreme violence and images of the enemy as unredeemed beasts. In the case of Kalisz, the oft-repeated narrative encouraged Russians to identify the Polish people with the Russian cause, eclipsing the usual suspicion of the Poles under Russian rule as disloyal. Symbols and rituals were important, and not only for the undereducated. Although the Tsar bore full responsibility for the declaration of war, it was obvious that society could not be ignored in such a serious crisis. Nicholas therefore called a special one-day session of the Fourth Duma for July 26, old style. The deputies first gathered in the Winter Palace, where they heard their sovereign insist that war had been thrust upon them. He called on them also to shoulder the imperial mission. "We defend not only our honour and dignity on Russian land," he said, "we fight also for the Slavs, our brothers in blood and faith." From the Winter Palace, the deputies proceeded along the Neva embankment to the Duma's chamber in the Tauride Palace. Asserting their unity of spirit, the political parties pledged to suspend their mutual antagonism and temper their hostility to the regime. The subject nationalities pledged their loyalty. The mistreated minorities adjourned their resentments. In creating a sense of common cause, "We are all Russians," an early pamphlet declared, "the German threat has done us a great service, the final service the Germans will perform for Russia." Faced with the strident nationalism of recently united Germany, the Russian Empire in fact struggled to find a mobilizing idiom in reply. Nationalism was associated with the urges of Poles and Finns to achieve independence, a threat, not a resource. On behalf of society, the Duma deputies endorsed the imperial mission. They hailed Russia's duty to defend not only the Slavic peoples united with us in faith and blood, but also the honour, dignity and integrity of Russia and her position among the great powers. Duma President Rodzianko affirmed the people's faith in their ruler and in God's providence. Ethnic and cultural minorities might not be expected to display the same patriotic zeal, a vulnerability of which the enemy was well aware. It was necessary, therefore, to assert the integrity and unity of the state, Rodzianko insisted. The various peoples on Russian soil would unite, he promised, in one fraternal family to defend their common fatherland. The deputies intoned the imperial hymn, God Save the Tsar, Mighty Sovereign and Orthodox. Sincere as their patriotism may have been, the tone struck by ministers and deputies in these opening moments of the war was nevertheless defensive. In particular, they rejected the German charge that Russia's early mobilization had been an implicit declaration of war, to which the Central Powers had merely been responding. Foreign Minister Sazonov described the Austrian bombardment of Belgrade in July as a pogrom of the peaceful inhabitants. He cited the heroism of the Belgian people and denounced German aggression as a violation of the international laws of war. As an empire, however, Russia faced dangers from within. In the spirit of national unity, Rodzianko accepted the suspension of the Duma at least into the coming year. His acquiescence, on patriotic grounds, angered a number of party leaders, but suited the purposes of Guryamikhin and Minister of the Interior Maklakov. The Fourth Duma was no threat, of course, to the established order. The moderates welcomed the opportunity for cooperation and the chance to demonstrate support for the war. The relatively more oppositional Cadet Party, in support of the struggle against German domination in Europe, agreed to defer its political goals. Its leader, Pavel Milyakov, vowed that the liberals would fulfill their duty as citizens of the empire. Whatever their attitude toward the government, their obligation was to suspend domestic conflict and support the men at the front. Even the socialists capitulated, as they had across Europe, but without renouncing their critical stance. Alexander Kerensky rose to declare that socialists had no enemies among the workers of other nations, driven into fratricidal conflict by the ruling classes of Europe. If all countries were to be guided by the democratic principles of liberty, equality, and fraternity, there would be no war. Kerensky nevertheless pledged the democracy to support the war, but complained that the government, even at this dark moment, continued to exacerbate the country's internal divisions. It mistreated the non-Russian peoples and did nothing to relieve the burden of the labouring poor. Peasants and workers must nevertheless rise to the defence of their country. Fight the war to make the revolution. Vladimir Lenin, in exile, made no secret of opposing the war, but the handful of Bolshevik Duma deputies kept silent. When they gathered illegally in November, they were arrested, further reducing the size of the Duma left. If Minister of the Interior Maklakov hoped the arrest would arouse public protest, which could be used as an excuse to suppress the Duma once and for all, he was disappointed. None of the liberals publicly objected. Milyakov, for one, damned the Bolsheviks as traitors. Special legislation, nevertheless, deprived the Duma of some of its former powers, and Maklakov did all he could to thwart civic initiatives in support of the war. The minister's distrust of public life was particularly incongruous and self-defeating at a moment when the public overwhelmingly favoured cooperation. The troubled minorities in the Duma added their voices to the chorus. The representative of the German-descended population of the Baltic region asserted their loyalty to throne and fatherland. The Latvian and Estonian deputies declared that neither nationality, nor language, nor religion prevent us Lithuanians and Estonians from being ardent patriots of Russia, ready to defend our fatherland shoulder to shoulder with the great Russian people against the arrogant foe. The ghost of nationalism nevertheless hovered over the sentiments expressed by a deputy from one of the Polish provinces, recalling the tragic position of the Polish people, deprived of independence and the expression of their own will. Divided among the warring powers, Poles were tragically pitted against each other. The deputy nevertheless expressed the hope that the united Slavic peoples, under Russia's lead, would repel the advances of mighty Prussia, as Poland and Lithuania had done at the Battle of Grunwald in 1410. To shouts of bravo from all sides, he predicted that the fratricidal bloodshed would result finally in the unification of the Polish people. The Jews also harbored resentments. Naftali Friedman, deputy from the Lithuanian province of Kovna, though himself an ardent Zionist, reminded the assembly that the Jews considered themselves citizens and loyal sons of the fatherland, despite discrimination against them. Russia was their homeland, and they would shoulder arms together with everyone else. The deputy from Kazan province, representing its Muslim population, echoed the general's support for the war and expressed loyalty to Russia. Each protestation of loyalty, of course, testified to the danger of betrayal and fragmentation. While representatives of society across the board made a show of solidarity, the military itself displayed an alarming degree of incoherence. A war plan existed, but differences soon emerged. Minister of War Sukomlinov insisted Russia concentrate its forces against Germany in the northwest. Foreign Minister Sazonov wanted to direct them first against Austria in the southwest. Sazonov, however, gave in to pressure from France, which urged Russia to distract the Germans from their campaign in the west. When Grand Duke Nikolai Nikolaevich assumed his post as commander-in-chief, he ordered two Russian armies to cross the border into East Prussia. Though not yet at full strength, the Russian First Army, under General von Rennenkamp, headed west in the direction of Königsberg. The Second Army, led by General Alexander Samsonov, was to move west and then north from the Polish provinces. The two forces were to be coordinated by General Yakov Zielinski, commander of the Northwest Front. The plan was to encircle the German Eighth Army under General Maximilian von Prittwitz, which was positioned between them. On August 17, August 4 Old Style, Rennenkampf led his cavalry into East Prussia. From the very start, most of the problems that would later reach catastrophic proportions were already apparent. These included poor leadership, failures of communication, inadequate transportation, and severe shortages of supplies, guns, and ammunition. They also involved the long-standing divisions within the High Command between reformers associated with Sukomlinov and the traditionalist followers of the Grand Duke. The traditionalists continued to emphasize the defense of fortresses and the use of cavalry commanded largely by aristocratic officers. The reformers believed infantry and artillery were the key to modern warfare and considered fortresses a strategic and financial waste. When war broke out, conservative commanders gained the advantage over forward-looking administrators, but the tensions persisted. Rennenkamp, for example, was a traditionalist, Samsonov a reformist. Rennenkamp was not on speaking terms with his own chief of staff, who represented the opposite camp. Sukhomlinov hated him with a passion. The first challenges, however, were not personal but practical. How to mobilize sufficient manpower and resources in time to begin the westward march? How to supply the men with boots, rations, guns, and ammunition when Russian factories were not geared to war production? They were not geared even to the production of footwear. Men marched with rags on their feet. In early December 1914, General Yanushkevich at Stavka wrote to Sukomlinov, describing himself as hysterical. "My hair stands on end at the thought that lack of bullets and rifles will lead to Wilhelm's triumph. Many of the men have no boots, their feet are frozen, without winter coats they fall sick. As a result, when officers are killed, the men surrender in masses." The situation with communications was also dramatic. Samsonov had only 25 telephones and a few telegraph transmitters with which to reach his own troops and contact the First Army. The Russians, moreover, sent their wireless messages uncoded, which meant the Germans learned their plans in advance. Transportation also put the Russians at a disadvantage for reasons having to do with politics as much as geography. Russia was, of course, vastly more extended than Germany and less well served by railroads. The Polish salient was particularly ill-endowed. Intended to impede the progress of invading forces, the limitation now made it harder for Russians to mobilize in the opposite direction. Railroads were in general overtaxed by the many functions they had to fulfill, carrying troops to and from the front, the wounded to hospitals, refugees out of the war zone, supplies, and especially fodder for the horses. Horses were a key element in the Russian case, and not only on the battlefield. Undersupplied with motor vehicles and obliged to transport material from the railhead to the front, the Russians relied largely on horse and ox-drawn carts. In East Prussia, by contrast, the Germans were on home turf, well prepared and well supplied, operating on a compact terrain where they could rely on support from the local population. The first battle in the Eastern Theatre occurred at Gumbinen, now Gusiev, in the Kaliningrad district of Russia, directly east of the German fortress at Königsberg. The Germans had first achieved a minor victory over the Russians at Stalupernin, today Nesterov, then retreated to Gumbinen, where they hoped to dispatch the rest of the First Army before the arrival of the Second Army from the south. There, on August 20, Neustadt, Generals August von Mackensen and Hermann von François launched a devastating barrage that decimated Rennenkampf's forces. The Russians nevertheless managed to mount a counterattack, achieving their first victory. Rennenkampf then failed to take advantage of this favourable moment, turning instead to attack the fortress at Königsberg, which the Germans had abandoned. The timid Prittwitz was now replaced by the more forceful Paul von Hindenburg and Erich Ludendorff. With full access to Russian communications, the generals learned that Rennenkampf had stopped for supplies. Leaving sufficient troops to fool the enemy into thinking it was still in position, the German Eighth Army turned south to meet Samsonov. The First Army might have attacked the Germans from the rear, but failed to do so. Zhilinsky, who had only the vaguest idea where his own forces were positioned, ordered Samsonov to intercept the enemy as he retreats before the advancing army of General Rennenkampf. The enemy was not retreating. Rennenkampf was not advancing. Samsonov therefore encountered an army larger than he could have expected, freed by Rennenkampf's negligence to bring its full force to bear against him. After 6 days' march in the August heat, the Second Army finally arrived, short of supplies and ammunition, at the town of Allenstein, now Olsztyn in Poland, not far from Tannenberg, where the Germans had been defeated by the Poles and Lithuanians in 1410. This was the same Battle of Grunwald invoked by the Polish Duma deputy 2 weeks before. The fighting, in what Germans later dubbed the Battle of Tannenberg to avenge their 500-year-old humiliation, began on August 23, Neustadt, with what seemed a German retreat. Samsonov concluded that the enemy lacked confidence. Alas, by the next day, the Germans had intercepted all his telegrams. In full possession of his plans, they launched an attack. Rennenkampf, less well informed about his own troop movements than the Germans, had no idea what Samsonov was up to and failed to advance. Indeed, Zhilinsky, also in the dark, ordered Rennenkampf to keep his sights trained on Königsberg. By August 29, when Zhilinsky finally realized that the Second Army was under assault, it was too late. By then, after 5 days of battle, Samsonov's forces had suffered 50,000 casualties, including 7,000 dead. Hundreds of guns and thousands of horses were captured. Attempting to escape in the dark of night, Samsonov, who suffered from asthma and a weak heart, fell behind his companions and took his own life. His body was found and buried by German soldiers. The First Army, positioned near the Masurian Lakes, had still made no move. 3 days before Samsonov's suicide, however, it was attacked by the combined forces of the German Eighth Army. Unlike Samsonov, who at least had done his best, in the absence of intelligence and backup, to defend the honour of his command, Rennenkampf fled with unseemly haste as far back as Kovna, Lithuanian Kaunas, safe behind the Russian border. Even his defenders had to admit he had lost his nerve. His detractors called him General Rennen vom Kampf, running from battle. In a single month, his First Army had suffered 80,000 casualties, losing 150 guns and half its motorized vehicles. Together, the First and Second Armies lost 250,000 men. Zelinsky was immediately relieved of his command. Rennenkamp hung on a bit longer. The war against Germany thus began with defeats for the Russian side and the humiliating end of Rennenkamp's career. The myth of Tannenberg, which played a sinister role in later German history, only enhanced the German threat. The armies on the southwest front seemed to be in better hands under General Nikolai Ivanov and his chief of staff, General Mikhail Alexeyev. Ivanov was limited in his talents as a commander, but admired for his dedication. He had advanced from lowly beginnings, fought with the artillery in the Russo-Japanese War, and enjoyed the confidence of his men. He was now sent, along with the armies under General Nikolai Ruski, Pavel Plebia, and Alexei Brusilov, to engage the weaker Austrian opponent. Things did not begin well here, either. The Russians were defeated first at Krasnik, the day the Battle of Tannenberg began, and again at Komarov, 3 days later. But then they pushed the Austrians back at Gnila Lipa and went on to capture Lemberg, Polish Lvov, Russian Lvov, today Ukrainian Lviv. By the first week in September, the Russians were in position to smash the Austrian armies, which got wind of their plans and beat a hasty retreat southward to the Carpathian Mountains. The fortress of Shemeshel, west of Lemberg on the Sarn River, headquarters of the Austro-Hungarian Chief of Staff, was now surrounded. The Russian siege of Shemeshel began in late September, was lifted briefly in October, resumed in November, and lasted into March 1915, when the Austrians finally surrendered, leaving 110,000 men in Russian captivity. The Germans responded to Austria's loss of Lemberg by moving troops from East Prussia to a position west of the Polish salient, on a level with Warsaw, which they believed was vulnerable to attack. By the end of September, the new German Ninth Army, under Hindenburg and Ludendorff, was extended in a north-south line from Posen, today Polish Poznan, to Krakow. The Germans began their advance toward Warsaw, aiming for the gap between the Russian Second Army in Warsaw and the Russian Ninth Army on the Sarn, points joined by the north-south Vistula River, parallel to the western Polish border. Unaware of the German position, the Russians had decided to move their troops into this gap. Thus, from mid-September to early October, the antagonists faced each other from opposite sides of the river. The Germans were vastly outnumbered by the Russians, whose guns were not, however, powerful enough to prevail. The confrontation that ensued was known as the Battle of the Vistula River, or the First Battle of Warsaw. By mid-October, as German forces under General Mackensen were approaching Warsaw, further south along the Vistula, the Russian 4th and 9th Armies were engaging the Austrian 1st Army. The Germans then decided to retreat, and by the end of the month they were back where they had started. The First Battle of Warsaw was a much-needed Russian victory. Building on their success, the Russians directed their efforts towards Silesia, the German territory directly west of Kalisz, and including the city of Breslau, today Polish Wrocław. Having learned of the Russians' plans, Hindenburg, now in command of the Eastern Front, decided to intercept them. On November 11, Mackensen, capturing over 10,000 men, forced the First Army to retreat from its position south of the Vistula. The Second Army, meanwhile, tried to escape encirclement by retreating in the direction of Lodz. The Fifth Army arrived in time to knock out Mackensen's right flank as temperatures dropped with the sudden onset of winter. When Rennenkamp, still commanding the First Army, attacked from the east, the Germans pulled back. By November 22, however, they had surrounded Lodz from three sides. Although the Germans did not manage to complete the circle, the Russians were too weak to hold the city. A textile manufacturing center, crowded with thousands of wounded, including Poles fighting on both sides. Among the German commanders was General Karl Litzmann, in whose honor the town was later rechristened by the Nazis as Litzmannstadt, site of the notorious Lodz Jewish ghetto in World War II. Despite the shortage of rifles and ammunition, the Russians had anticipated victory. By the end of November, however, Lodz had fallen into German hands. At this point, Rennenkampf was relieved of his command. In the end, the Russians had prevented the Germans from taking Warsaw, while the Germans had blocked the Russian move into Silesia. The Russian public might well have been confused by the results of the first months of fighting. Humiliated in East Prussia by the powerful German forces, the Russian armies made a better showing, and under better leadership, against the weaker Austrians. The unexpected loss of Lodz was a blow to patriotic self-esteem. By the end of 1914, Russian forces on the combined East Prussian, Polish and Galician fronts had incurred 1 million casualties, killed and wounded. Officers were singled out, so losses among the officer corps were extremely high. Already in short supply, weapons were squandered on the battlefield and in retreat. Ill-trained soldiers dropped them as they fled. The Allies were shocked in December to learn the extent to which the Russians lacked guns and ammunition. The military censor assiduously followed the mood of the enlisted men by scrutinizing their letters, but not everyone could write. A more direct indication of disaffection was the rate of desertion, which rose with each military setback and continued to grow as the war progressed. By the end of the year, the educated public at least already felt a sense of foreboding. The military historian General Nikolai Golovin, in the field during the first months, recalled that gloomy rumors were finding their way from the army into the country, and tales of disorganization, together with forecasts of an approaching catastrophe, reached even places the most remote. In fact, in terms of territory, the results were something of a draw. On the one hand, the Germans controlled the Polish salient, as far east as Lodz, 50 miles from Warsaw. They had also seized the Latvian port of Liebau, after 1918 Liepāja, north of Königsberg on the Baltic coast. On the other hand, Russia occupied both Galicia, including the city of Lemberg, and East Prussia, where they had returned in October. Russia's gains were nevertheless overshadowed in domestic public opinion by the overall impression of disorganization and heavy losses. The distinguished Russian specialist in international law, Baron Mikhail von Tauber, later recalled the shock of the early defeats in East Prussia, which could, alas, not be erased by the brilliant offensive of our troops in Galicia. The fact is, the defeats on the German front barely a month into the war showed clearly that the Russian army was in no shape to defeat the Germans. Tauber had been among the conservatives' Cassandras who had predicted disaster to begin with. They seemed ever more prescient as time went on. 2. Germans, Jews, Armenians. If the opening months of fighting had alarmed the newspaper-reading public, 1915 failed to provide relief. A second battle with the Germans at the Masurian Lakes, part of Hindenburg's plan to push the Russians back beyond the Vistula, again resulted in a Russian defeat. The Russian army was encircled in the wintry Augustov Forest, today at the intersection of Poland, Belarus and Lithuania, and surrendered in late February at the cost of 30,000 prisoners.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.